Round two of the Masters concludes tonight as the top four seeds, Luke Humphries, Michael van Gerwen, Michael Smith and Nathan Aspinall, join the party. They play a quartet of last night's winners, who are also an impressive bunch.
Milton Keynes! It's time to meet the players.
Superb from the Dutchman. Look at that! What a win! That is the Dirk van Dijver Bodie.
Dimitri Vandenberg, Belgium's number one, in control of this game. It is a win for the Dreammaker.
Chris Dobie,
the Masters champ, survives, plays well, he does get the job done.
This is a very, very smart standard from Mr. Smith. And Stephen Bunting into the next round, what a comeback!
Nathan Aspinall is first up against Dirk van Dijvenbode. The Dutchman was very emotional last night after halting his losing streak in a last leg decider. The world number one and the world champion, Luke Humphries, is up against another player who went the distance in round one, Stephen Bunting. Then we have the five-time Masters champion, Michael van Gerwen, up against the defending champ, Chris Dobie. And we end up with the former world champion Michael Smith against Dimitri Vandenberg. A quality 4 hours or so of entertainment here for you on ITV3. Starting with these two, Chris Mason and Mark Webster with us. And it's been very entertaining so far. But another hallmark of what we've seen is the fact that so many of the matches, virtually all of them, have been really, really tight. All four matches this afternoon, 10-8, for example.
Yeah, it's going to be competitive at the Masters. It's the top 24 players. Yes, there's always that element of a bit of rust because they're coming off the back of the World Championships, haven't played for a few weeks, but it's been competitive. I'm not surprised, particularly this afternoon. Game's going right till the end. And 4-10-8, you don't often see that. But it's going to be the same tonight, I feel, and concluding tomorrow as well.
Yeah, it's just with the top 24 in it, like Mark said, you do get the odd one that opts to go on holiday for a couple of weeks. A lot of the players have not had that option this year with the introduction of the two World Series events. So, yeah, not surprised. Not surprised. And even the ones that have been beaten heavily, for example, Martin Schindler. I mean, he played beautifully, didn't he? He just walked into a tip-top form, Dave Chisnell.
Yeah, you get thumped 6-1, averaging 103. How's your luck, eh? But the finishing was a problem there, wasn't it? And Dirk van Dijvenbode, one of those players who's come into this tournament really looking to get the season off to a good start. I mean, he hasn't won a game since the Grand Slam, Mark, bearing in mind he's had a real problem with his shoulder. How vital was it that he got past Ryan Searle?
Yeah, credit to him for just keep putting himself out there as well. He hasn't been withdrawing from events. You felt that maybe at the back, particularly the Players' Championship finals, maybe there's an avenue to withdraw there, have some rest for the world. But he's kept putting himself through it. He's been having setbacks. Knowing that you can't play to your ability, not because of commitment, because of an injury, is even more frustrating. But to get over the line yesterday, he chased a lot in that game, but he found a way. And the reaction at the end, he was almost in tears. It was a huge victory for Dirk van Dijvenbode. And regardless of what happens tonight in his match, it's something to clutch to. And there's a little bit of hope there now.
Yeah, Dirk's first up against Nathan Aspinall. How do you see that going?
Yeah, it's a tough one. In the Worlds, in the opening set of his match against Boris Krutchmar, he averaged 108 and looked $1 million. The problem was the length of that match, and that may be an issue here for him because, of course, now it's a race to 10, a much shorter format in round one. And you expect Aspinall to come back with a bit of a bang. That's what usually happens with him. And you know you don't get too much out of Aspinall. You know, he's a real fighter, a real street fighter up there, and he loves to battle. And I'm not sure whether Dirk would love a long match battling against someone like Aspinall, but I think he's accepted the injury. And when you see his reactions and the way he's moving around and the celebrations, it looks like, I mean, obviously we don't know, we're not going through what he's going through, but it looks like he's somewhat getting over whatever the issue was. And I'm with Mark. I think now it's a rebuilding of confidence process for him and learning how to win again.
Yeah, he says he's able to bench press now, which is a good sign, and to celebrate the way he did, which is also a good sign, especially for his walk-on, which is pretty high octane as well. Another player who came through a last leg decider is Stephen Bunting. Had to really show a lot of resilience against Ross Smith, former European champion, to come through that. And the fans love him here, and he seems to be on a bit of a roll, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's embracing it, Stephen Bunting. He's a popular guy, he's a good guy. And that comeback was even more remarkable because it wasn't against a player that folded. Ross Smith maintained a decent level. I think he only missed one dart at a double. Bunting from 5-2 just showed that he's got these gears now and he's playing relaxed. He changed his equipment sort of midway through last year, added 6 grams on his dart. That's a lot, that's a big change. But he's ran with it. He's literally dismissed the old darts, he's kept them. And he's performing and he's enjoying playing, he's confident. When he does lose games as well and you bump into him in the corridor, he's positive, he's taking the positive going to the next tournament, and it's good to see because he's had a bit of a rollercoaster at times, Stephen Bunting, but he's so competitive at the minute.
Well, I bumped into Stephen Bunting in the corridor. He wasn't positive at all. He was devastated at the loss of Jurgen Klopp from his beloved Liverpool. He's like, who's going to take over? I said, I've no idea. That's all he wanted to talk about. But anyway, in terms of the next player that has played really well recently, that is Michael Smith, who won in Cardiff on the opening night of the Premier League on Thursday night. How do you see him getting on here?
Yeah, and he needed that. He's another one that needed a bit of an injection of confidence. And my goodness, didn't he have to do it the tough way, beating Gezi Price on his... On home turf in the final, Littler in the semi-final, MVG in the opening game, and that will give him lots of confidence coming into tonight, and he needs it because it's been a tough 12 months since, well, he won the Worlds, then went to Bahrain, lifted that. Since then, he's may have taken his eye off the ball, enjoyed the fruits of his labour and spending a bit of time with the family, because for the last 10 years, it's literally just been all dark. So. Yeah, I expect a big year from Michael Smith and I expect him to bounce back.
Yeah, he has admitted that, hasn't he? He said he wanted to enjoy all the trappings of being world champion and why not? And at least he knows it's down to the fact that he wasn't practicing as much as to why his form wasn't spectacular. But another match we're really looking forward to tonight. Michael van Gerwen, 5-time Masters champion in a row in this venue, but not since 2019, up against the defending champ, Chris Dobie. How'd you call that one?
Yeah, it's a tough one. Chris Dobie's a lot more streetwise now after the last 18 months. There was a collapse against Rob Cross in the match play 18 months ago, and that made him into a stronger player. He went on to have a run at the quarterfinals at the Worlds. He was beaten by Michael, but then he won this event last year. Premier League, he came seventh. That didn't do him justice. He was excellent in that. He's just a better player now. He's stronger. When he has moments in tournaments where he's eliminated, like the heartbreak of losing to Rob Cross, he's not a sulker, Chris Dobie. He's straight back on the practice board. And I think he'll be enjoying the pressure of being defending champion. It's not going to make him nervous. And he'll relish the challenge of facing Michael tonight.
Yeah, what do you think we can expect from Luke Humphreys up against Bunting here? The new world number one, the world champion. He's got all the attention for himself here. There's no Luke Littler. We're not going to be talking about him too much. We won't all be asking questions about him. Do you think that'll maybe benefit him slightly, do you think?
Maybe. I think for him, his feet just haven't touched the ground since winning the Worlds. He's the demands of a world champion, all the media stuff and TV programmes, interviews all over the country. And I just don't think he's had time to take a breath. I spoke to him and he said, not really been able to do the type of practice that you need to do, which is totally different than just stood at a board throwing darts. It's a little bit more complex than that. But he's so talented. He's got so much confidence right now. And we can't be surprised if he wins tournaments because he's making a habit of it.
Yeah, we had an interview with him here at 6:45 last night, in case you want to watch back on ITVX. And he spoke to us really openly about the fact that it has been crazy. It's not a case of not wanting to practice. It's been a case of it's just been wild that first month since winning the World Championship. So it's not a surprise. But do you expect to see him back on his A game here tonight, or could he be a little bit
I expect him
affected.
To play well, but it's a challenge for him. But I think the practice element will just roll into one now because he's going to be playing all the time. He's going to go Premier League to Pro Tour. I think that'll take care of himself. I think this is a perfect tournament for Luke.
Okay, well, let's see. We are set for a fabulous evening of darting entertainment here at the Marshall Arena in Milton Keynes. It's sold out again. Every single session is sold out here for the very first time. And let's head over to John McDonald to get the first player on stage. A couple of crowd-pleasing players with crowd-pleasing walk-ons.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You've joined us live on ITV3. From the Marshall Arena here in Milton Keynes. Welcome to the second round action of the Kazoo Masters. That's all brought to you by the Professional Darts Corporation. And now, ladies and gentlemen, for the thousands joining us live and the millions joining us around the world, it's time to meet the players from the Netherlands, a World Grand Prix runner-up. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of 6 PDC titles. Would you please welcome the Titan, Dirk van Dijvenbode! Ladies and gentlemen from England, the winner of the UK Open, the US Darts Masters, and a warm match play, it's the Ash, Nathan Aspinall!
Legs for a place in the quarterfinals. Alan Warren a little and Dan Dawson will kick us off in the commentary box.
Yeah, let's get this evening underway with a game that usually guarantees fireworks, but there is a serious asterisk over that at the moment. Nathan Aspinall, the world match play champion, of course, has not been playing his best since picking up that prestigious title at Blackpool Winter Gardens last summer. And Dirk van Dijvenbode, it's difficult to describe it as anything other than a bit of a crisis. His win in the first round against Ryan Searle, he looked like he was almost in tears on stage. He said he'd never celebrated a win that much because it meant so much to him. The injury problems that he's suffered from over the last few months have completely derailed a man who, at this time last year, was the most exciting darts player on the planet, arguably the most informed player on the planet, and the world was his oyster. But two injury problems have left him trying to rebuild, and at the minute, despite that win against Ryan Searle, it looks like there's quite a lot of rebuilding to do. But this is an opportunity for the Titan.
Yes, and at that point, Dan, as you pointed out, he was even whispered about the Premier League because he was such a popular player. He's walk-on, and you know, in Players' Championships, he's always there and thereabouts, a hatful during the season. Just shows you what an injury can do, but certainly the walk-on music that would bless any rave from both of them. Certainly got the crowd up for this match. Normally, as you said, should be both players bouncing. But we will see. Dirk will get us underway.
Dirk van Dijvenbode, a player whose arrival is heralded by the waft of deep heat. Stings the nostrils.
97.
Liberally applied. You can actually...
With a spade.
Yeah. You can pick up traces of it in the air, pretty much all the way from the players' room to the stage.
Yeah, you can understand the emotion last night because it's, as he's looking for a match, not quite. But you can understand the emotion that when you've been at the top of your game, an injury sets you back so much and you just can't buy a win, and then you get one. And then the release of emotion was there there for all to see.
Well, it's an upward trajectory for Dirk over the last few years. He picked up a title in 2021, doubled that tally the following year, three titles last year, and it could have been a load more. He was missing championship darts and the Euro Tour on more than one occasion. He won three of the first 10 events last year and was averaging 110 plus on a pretty regular basis.
The TV finals as well, and almost got over the line. I remember they won the Gezi Prize. Last leg decided for him first. So that was the level he was playing at.
Yeah, and it's all
still number 13.
Yeah, and it's all built on his scoring power. The biggest 180 hitter in the world when he was fit. Now he's kind of been superseded by the likes of Ross Smith, among many others, to be honest, over the last few months. He leaves himself 82 in this opening leg. Good start, this. 17 for tops.
52.
Just the wrong side. Just makes it awkward when he returns. Nathan not got his scoring boots on yet. Only in the first leg.
And for the first leg, Dirk van Dijvenbode. So, ladies and gentlemen, to throw first. Game.
Nice.
16 dancer.
Nothing wrong with that whatsoever.
It's a longer format game. He got through that game with Ryan Searle, even though it went the full 11 legs. It's very, very likely that this game is going to last longer than 11 legs. And so how can Dirk play over a slightly longer format? Because you would think, with the practice he's been doing already, he's only got a certain number of minutes before that shoulder slash arm issue starts to make itself more evident.
It's how the game's going, isn't it? Because if he's winning and playing well, you don't feel the pain as much. If you're behind, you've missed a few doubles, your players put, you just seem to feel that injury just a little bit more. It's all in the mind.
Yeah, I mean, basic. I think everybody can understand that. But we saw the World Championship. Mace picked up at it at the top of the show, didn't he? Played Boris Kritchmar and was amazing in the first set, average 108. And then as the game went on, it just, he seemed unable to even sustain anything like that.
Yeah, and you mentioned the longer format last night was draining. It's almost like playing two of those if it goes all the way, this one. So, one long way to go. He's had a good start. See what he can build on. He's not being pushed that much at the moment by Nathan. And looky there, in and out of the treble.
Well, the concern as well for Dirk with the injury is that even if he's not trying to, his body could be making compensations to deal with the discomfort that he's feeling, and his throw changes, so the darts aren't getting to the board as he's used to, and that can basically affect his ability.
Nathan Urquhart, 96.
A good visit despite leaving a finish, so chance for Aspinall. Get himself up and running.
60. Urquhart 153.
So already in the second leg, he's doing the stretches with the arm. He does that a lot anyway. It just seems more proficient at this moment in time.
And John 90. Doesn't get it.
99. Urquhart 36.
Dirk there attempting to leave double seven.
I was just thinking that.
He does some really interesting things on the board, Dirk van Dijvenbode. Double nine, the switch. Yeah, is found. Nathan Aspinall levels the game up.
The leg is Dirk through first.
Yeah, crucial last start there, just struggling a little bit on the double. Almost leaving the door open for his opponent.
44.
I think the way the game's gone, there's going to be some quality darts, but there's going to be a lot of loose darts the way they've both started in the first two legs.
140.
He's got a rather frustrating habit, Nathan Aspinall. I imagine it's very frustrating for him, of starting some games pretty slowly. The amount of heroic comebacks or near comebacks that he has pulled off against big name players in massive games, major finals, remember the World Grand Prix final. He really can drag himself back into contention from anywhere, but he would rather not be way back after the first few legs or sets in big games and major tournaments.
Yeah, you leave yourself with a mountain to climb with the standard of the top players nowadays. Got a good chance to break here.
93.
And very early on in the match, that'll give him a lot of confidence. I think it's just all about playing now. Yes, the Premier League started. The ranking events start a week on Monday in Wigan. Two Players' Championships and two European Tour qualifiers.
Yeah, and Nathan's going to be playing in him.
140.
Last year, he ducked out of a lot of them. Didn't even get himself to Minehead in the Players' Championship final.
96th or something he ended up.
Yes,
he was didn't play the last few because he didn't think he was...
Yeah, he gave up. Yeah. He gave up trying to get there.
102.
Takes a big bite out of that.
170.
This is the big one. Can't start proceedings though. So chance for Aspinall to break throw. Good lead by Big Dirk though. Just in case.
65.
25 and tops. I'll hit the ball. That's always the danger. picks off the seven to leave double four. Very nicely done by the Asp. Breaks the Van Dijvenbode throw and goes into the lead.
Yes, that was lovely and smooth there. Didn't put any pressure on himself. He just got himself set. As soon as he hit the bullseye, he knew what was on offer. And now he's starting to flow. And we get the response.
You like that result, don't you? You like a bit of aggression.
Absolutely love it. I think the crowd like it as well because it shows the personality of the player as well. Oh. He's getting a bit of a boo there because he missed a treble. But I just like to see some of that in a game. It just shows that they wear the heart on the sleeve and what it means to them. They want to get stuck in. Just don't want to overdo it, obviously. But they like to see a good celebration, don't they?
Well, look, some players... We've seen one this afternoon, Daryl Gurney, who tries to keep his emotions in check. I can see you doing your best Andrew Gilding celebration impression, Wazza. And yes, he is not what you would call an effusive celebrator. But other players like Dirk, like Nathan, the aggression and letting out actually seem... They seem to benefit from having a bit of adrenaline coursing through their veins.
Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah, everybody's different, aren't they? Some people respond differently. Some people want to really keep that focus and just move on to the next leg. Some people have an explosion. A Gezi Price explosion.
86.
It's great to see. The crowd love it as well, it's got to be said.
Oh, 82. And new bar 78.
Federal 18 for double 12. 20 for tops then. Plum central, so he's going to have to navigate his way past that. And he does do expertly there, Nathan Aspinall. Three legs on the spin, taking control of this in the early stages.
Yes, and two clean doubles.
Dirk has got the marginally higher average at the moment, but as you can see, he's only had two darts at double. And if you're outscoring Dirk van Dijvenbode, then you've got a very good chance of winning the game because all of Dirk's success, a lot of his success over the last few years, has been built on him getting to checkouts before you do because he hits so many big trebles.
Yes, that's his armoury.
8.
Still got to hit them when you get there. Look at Ross Smith last night, who was seemingly the far superior player against Stephen Bunting. And mismatched dart, lost the game, and will not be back tonight. The bullet is in action against Luke Humphries, the world number one.
Yes, you almost feel a little bit for Ross Smith because he seems to get embroiled in these titanic tussles of high averages and comes out the wrong end.
Well, it's happened to him twice at the World Championship against Dirk van Dijvenbode. The record-breaking game for 180. And he still lost it.
Nathan's shaking his head there, but he's just trying to get his game together. He's in a great position. Dirk's just dipped, started reasonably well. First leg was pretty solid. Just lost his scoring, which is his main attribute.
140.
I think the assessment of Dirk's injury has changed repeatedly. Originally, he was saying it might take 2 years to fix, and then it made an unexpected progression. It wasn't that bad, but I think it's changing all the time.
Well, only he'll know and the people around him what he needs to do. And at some point, whatever that decision is, he's got to make a decision.
He may have to just say, I'll write off X number of months and try and, you know, whether it's surgery or what. But for now, he's been so good. He's in all the TV tournaments. He doesn't want to miss out on any of them. But
82.
At the minute, he needs a shadow of his former self, and this could be 4-1 for Nathan Aspinall.
Yeah, it's not just that, is it? It's, does it make the injury worse? Do you lose your confidence?
Just alongside that one. Not like that. Now, if Dirk van Dijvenbode can pin this and get away 3-2 down from the first session, I think he'll take it. He's going to trouble 16 ball. Really? I said he did interesting things.
93.
I don't understand it, but Dirk's going to Dirk.
Well, they have the ways.
That is the way to take out 10, and Nathan Aspinall has taken a 4-1 lead. Lost the opening leg, won the next four, and Dirk van Dijvenbode, after a pretty solid start, is fading, and he needs to change that. Saturday night Masters Darts, it's day two here in Milton Keynes. This is what happened in the afternoon session. Every single game going deep, every one of them finishing by 10 legs to 8, including Darryl Gurney, the man parachuted into the tournament last minute, seeing off Joe Cullen to reach the quarterfinals. Damon Hetter, excellent in overcoming Rob Cross, looking very, very good, is the Aussie number one. Dave Chisnell and Peter Wright finding their way through to the final day of action here at the Marshall Arena as well. Four more players will join them tonight. And the early stages of this one, it is Nathan Aspinall who holds all the aces. He's won four legs on the spin, having lost the opening one. Dirk van Dijvenbode is averaging, well, I mean, Nathan's only averaging 86, but it's good enough at the minute. Dirk van Dijvenbode, an 84 average, but only three darts at double in those opening five legs, which is going to inflate the average because most of his visits are scoring and setup shots, and yet he still isn't even getting into the 90s. This is not the Dirk van Dijvenbode who was looking like a potential multiple major winner at the start of last year.
No, he seems a long way away from that, doesn't he, at this moment in time, and certainly over the last few months. It's just, well, maybe that spark last night winning the game, you kind of think, well, will that spur him on for the weekend? There's just nothing there. I mean, that's okay. Those leg-winning darts are pretty decent, but not power darts, are they?
108!
Four close games this afternoon, as you saw, this doesn't look likely to be the same.
Mind you, the Peter Wright game didn't look like it was going to be close when he was 6-0 up on Christoph Rutajski, and that changed.
6-0 and 8-3, I think.
134.
Did well to hold himself together in the end. That dart at tops, crucial. Let's see what the break has done for both players. Sometimes you can gather your thoughts in the back room and get yourself set for the second session.
Nathan here is the number four 92. Seed, world number four, career high ranking for the ASP following that victory at the World Match Play. Believes he's ascended to a new tier of darts player, reached a new level, the real, true elite. But with that comes expectation.
434. Making you require 86.
And every time you play, there's so many events now, you can maybe look over a season and do well in so many, but everybody will analyse it over every match that you play.
Great dart, leaves double 16. That's a superb checkout from Nathan Aspinall. And Dirk van Dijvenbode sat on a single to double combination for a rare chance to win a leg in this match, is left stranded high and dry and now sent back to 5-0-1.
He actually had a decent leg there, Dirk, scoring-wise. Probably one of his best of the match so far.
421.
He didn't get the opportunity. I just feel that if Nath can just stay solid or solid plus, get over the line quite quickly here.
Well, look, all the players know that Dirk is struggling at the moment. And so Nathan is probably feeling, having got this four-leg lead, all he has to do is maintain this kind of level. He feels like he's playing well within himself and still in control of the match. You're not trying to play, you know, subpar, average stuff. Just do enough. He'll be trying to hit nine darters every single leg, but it won't be that stressful an experience, I would imagine, for Nathan at the moment.
No, it certainly won't be stressful because he knows he's not getting pushed. So it's all about his game here. So he's got to really dig deep and try and get his game going. He mentioned that he hasn't really got going in the season so far. Practice-wise, obviously the season hasn't started in terms of the ranking events. You've got to use the opportunity that you get to get the game back to where it should be. Because they both like that adrenaline game, don't they? It's not there, so it's not spurring either one of them on.
You get the feeling in a normal game between these two, if they're fully fit, if one of them went, if one of them exploded into life, you'd expect the other one to go with him. The thing is, Dirk could explode into life. Nathan may go with him. If Nathan really does get going, you wonder whether Dirk's got it in him. That's a great dart. Leaves double top.
70.
And then he is fourth and fifth darts at double of the match, and he does not find the target.
Yeah, this is one of the best shots to see. Another one of those for double 16. Oh, unlucky.
92. Dirk required 20.
A little look over his shoulder there. I'm not sure if Dirk dropped his dart at the time. Seemed completely accidental, but does come back to the board. Desperately trying to find a second leg, and he does find the double. Punches himself in the head. Cuts the gap to three legs.
Here we go. Number three for this. So normally you would see Dirk fire one back at him, give it the old 1-0. And then we'll be up and running, but it just can't seem to get that going. And you wonder sometimes that because he knows he's got an injury, he's almost expecting not to play well, if you see what I mean. He knows it's not quite there. You know, he's up there trying, I can assure you of that.
58.
But everything else is against you.
It just must be a frustrating experience for Dirk. It's frustrating anyway when he suffered a rather comedy injury of falling over on his walk-on in his home country last year and injured his leg. And that kind of set him back, but he was just coming out of that little malaise when the shoulder went, and it's a much more serious problem. And you know, I don't want to labour the point about his injury, but it is obviously a huge factor in Dirk van Dijvenbode as a dart player in the minute. The difference between him at the start of the year and the end of the year, he's 7 or 8 points on his average. That's a dart every leg. And that costs you games, it costs you titles.
Yeah, it's not in just his obvious play, but psychologically as well, when it's been dragging on for so long.
Ooh, how about this? How about this, Nathan Aspinall going for it?
139.
Good attempt. A little grimace and smile at the end. And he knows he's in a good position in the leg and the match.
98. Nathan Iroquois, 25.
Tidy up time. Double 8.
He's just having to recompose there because he was disgusted with that first attempt at double eight. But puts it right, re-establishes that four-leg gap.
Yes, there it is, Nathan. You can see he's under no stress or pressure whatsoever. Dirk just needs to, I think it could be a 180 maybe, to just give him that belief for the rest of the match, because he's up there trying his heart out. But everything else is niggling in his mind.
It just looks hard work for him.
That
was a decent visit. He's got to make the decision. I mean, obviously, he'll be speaking to his manager, his friends, family. But I suppose the bottom line is the final decision is his. What he's going to do.
I mean, I don't know over the years, was it? If you're looking at Dutch players who at any given moment you could argue are the best player in the world, obviously Michael van Gerwen has been that player for a long while. Raymond van Barneveld would have been at some point, but there can't have been many others that you would have said have a very, very good argument to say that guy is better than everybody else on the planet right now. And Dirk van Dijvenbode was in that position in the early stages of last year.
Yeah, he'd been coming to tournaments and fancying himself to win them.
Every single one of them.
Yeah. Because of the level he was playing at, because he was beating all the top players in the Pro Tour, European Tour, in some of the TV events. Very hard to get it back. The longer it drags on.
96. They're going to go 138.
Now what's his plan here? Starting up the board. Doesn't work out. He can snag a treble 20, which he does, leave himself tops.
Still fighting away. For tops.
81.
To get three on the board.
40. Just changing the angle slightly. It's a great marker. And he's trying to come in from a different angle to get more of the barrel to slide down. It didn't quite work.
Yeah, he's normally a player that forces them through, isn't he? Power thrower, I suppose.
Gets the travel double top for a 1-2-5. Oh, Nathan Aspinall, it is a sickener for Dirk van Dijvenbode. Three darts missed at tops. Aspinall only needs one. It is 7-2, and it is turning into a rout.
Yes, he enjoyed that one, didn't he? Stopped just for a fraction of a second to move left for tops, waiting for the photo.
95.
Before it went in tops. Fabulous finish there, but Dirk had his chance. It's a step longer between throws as well. Yes, okay, we've mentioned the injury a million times and probably will again.
58.
He's not normally taking that long between throws if he's on a bad dart. He's fluent, even though he gets himself set.
Yeah, but a lot
it's
of
affecting
the time.
Everything.
Yeah, exactly. Affects the rhythm. It may be even affecting how he's using the board. I'm not sure if he's feeling more comfortable throwing at different parts of the board, but it's just difficult to know. With so many of the players, particularly players like Dirk, will play at different speeds. He will often speed, a bit like Damon Hetter, when he's playing well and hitting the targets he wants, then he'll go into overdrive. But because at no point in this game has he had an extended spell where he has felt, yes, I'm playing well here, he can't get up to that top speed. And so everything's a struggle.
6. That's the normal speed he throws at him. Powers his darts through, couldn't quite hit the treble there. As soon as it's not in that line, it stopped him in his tracks.
140.
Only his third 140, and he's at 0-180s, and we're in the 10th leg, and we're talking about a guy who has been one of the most devastating scorers in this sport for some time.
Second leg material, isn't it? Yeah. He's on three of those, normally. What's he going to do here? Starting on the 18, so looking at a setup, big 20 will do that. Nathan's had a wonderful 1-2-5 in the last leg, starting on the ball. Should start on the ball here.
Well, just show that you can hit it. Dirk missed three at tops in the last leg. This time he manages to pin it, and it's a rather sarcastic thumbs up to himself there for Dirk van Dijvenbode. He's managed to get a third leg in this contest, but Nathan Aspinall is four legs up and just three away from the quarter-final. Welcome back to the Marshall Arena, where Nathan Aspinall, the world match play champion and world number four, looks like he's strolling through to the quarterfinals. He's 7-3 up on Dirk van Dijvenbode, but to follow this game, it is the world champion and world number one, Cool Hand Luke Humphries, against the bullet Stephen Bunting, who snuck through the opening round last night, beating his good mate Ross Smith. Winner of this game, by the way, will face Daryl Gurney, the man who shouldn't have been here, but got a very late call-up with Gerwyn Price's withdrawal. And to be honest, it's going to take a monumental change in momentum in this game for Dirk van Dijvenbode to turn this around. And while we did nearly see it when Ratajski played Peter Wright earlier, it would be even more improbable for Dirk to do it here.
Yeah, that's because Christoph Ratajski raised his game, was averaging well in the late 90s to get back in the match. And Dirk's just not looking likely to do that because his consistent scoring isn't there. You mentioned again, 3-140s, still on three, and we're in leg 11. And his biggest armoury was always his scoring. And he's frustrating himself even more. Throw on throw on throw. His mind must be scrambled eggs at the moment.
80.
Aspinall's not had to do anything special. That'll be doubly frustrating for Dirk, because you'll see Nathan thinking, you're not looking like a world number four, you're not playing like a reigning world match play champion, and yet I'm letting you dominate this game.
Yes, it's a struggle for him. If he wants to play, he's got to play through the pain. Not just the physical, but the mental scar as well.
That's more like it.
On a sixpence.
And there's a little case in point about how when Dirk van Dijvenbode is playing his proper stuff, he is a devastating scorer, because it's how he groups those darts so tightly together. He could get another 9 in there.
Shanghai here, 306. Can't quite do it. It's okay though. Gives himself a double. Do you remember he took the last leg against the throw before the break? This would put him within 3.
60. Okay, required 20.
Cut the gap.
Well,
he couldn't say it was much of a marker, but he did find the double 10 with his next dart.
Well, he's digging deep, despite the obvious general lack of quality from both, it has to be said. And when I say quality, I mean what we expect of these players, not just because they're playing not their best at this moment in time. From Dirk's point of view, he's won the last two legs. He's got to try and build on that. If he's really, really struggling with his throw, it's going to be very difficult to change.
Persevering on the treble 20. And he comes away with a ton. He can reach the quarterfinals of the Masters for the third time in four campaigns. It was only last year where he suffered an early exit. That was in the last leg decided to Stephen Bunting. Semi-final and quarterfinals in the first 2 years he played in this tournament, Nathan.
57.
It's difficult to analyse what Nathan's thinking because he knows he's in a good position despite losing the last couple of legs.
38.
He's almost trying to fight himself as well. Dirk's doing the same. Trying to get his game going, trying to get some fluency in his throw.
434.
Practice all you want in the back room, at home, in the pub, wherever you do it. It's not down to what you do on stage.
434. 110.
And even a two treble visit from Dirk doesn't really put him in the frame. Single 18. Leaves double 16. Yeah. 3 seconds on plus finish of the match. Nathan Aspinall adds a 110 to the 125 he hit a few legs ago. He is two legs away from a meeting with Daryl Gurney.
100.
Dirk just seems to be trying to throw a little bit quicker.
81.
Both in the mid-80s on the averages.
58.
12 out of 31 on the doubles between them.
If Aspinall does go on to win this game, he will not care, will he? I know nobody really cares about their average if they win, but in this situation, he has never felt in any real danger in this match.
77.
Gone 4-1 up at the first break. Continued to win legs, and yeah, all right, he hasn't played brilliantly, he's finished okay, and he has done what's required of him. He knows he will have to find some more gears as the tournament goes on if he does have designs on winning.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's what he'll be thinking in his mind. He knows he's in a good position and probably will go on to win this match. And, looking for another match. There we go. He's making a fight of it in this last session, but I think from Nathan's point of view, he's going to be disappointed in his performance.
180.
Back to back.
Both hit 180s to leave 80 odd finishes for the 16th segment, and he's slipped into the 8th segment, and it means he doesn't get a dart for the leg. Nathan Aspinall is likely to start on the ball here. For tops.
Putting one leg away.
42. Berkey required 32.
Just next to that.
Nice.
He goes the wrong side, and it's another leg where Dirk, and there haven't been a huge number of legs where he's had darts at double, but there have been more than a couple where he's missed three in a row. Aspinall does not return the favour. It is 9-4, another break, and the Asp has the darts, looking to complete what, to be honest, has looked like a regulation win from quite early on in this game. There's been no lack of effort from Dirk van Dijvenbode, but it does look like it is a real struggle for him just to reach his average game that we've seen from him in the last few years.
Yeah, he's dug deep, hasn't he, in this last session, a couple of maximums, but he has had the opportunity in the last one. And back to 8-5 from where he was, really struggling, would have been a good return.
100.
Nathan just almost wants to get off stage. I'm sure Dirk does as well. Nathan just wants to get the next leg or next possible leg, whether it's this one or the next one.
104.
Go in the back room, moan to everybody, and then come back tomorrow.
And he might only be a couple of visits away from doing exactly that.
41.
Good adjustment. Finds his way through to the treble.
One.
Halves his score, leaves a ton. Already taken out finishes of 125 and 110. If he can add a ton to that, this is done.
58. Yes,
has been with quite a lot of the legs. There won't be any pressure on the visit. We'll be quite happy with a big 20 here to leave tops.
6.
Move on to the quarterfinals.
Well, the frustration is evident. The problems are evident for Dirk van Dijvenbode. But that's not Nathan Aspinall's problem. His problem is hitting a winning double.
96.
Another chance for Dirk. Get more leg on the board. Good start.
60.
Just not to be.
Nathan, you require.
Even when he's throwing
10.
Decent darts, they're rarely finding the target he wants. So double 5 to bring it to an end. Goes 3 for double 1. He nearly bust it on the treble. And
8.
Doesn't win it on the madhouse.
Nathan, you require 36.
It's turning into madness.
Leg, Dirk van Dijk.
Dirk gets another one on the board.
15 leg, it's Dirk to throw first.
Well, he's missed 5 match darts there, Nathan Aspinall. His finishing up until that point was pretty good. He was just shy of the 50% mark. It's a bit of a stat ruiner for the ass.
96.
Because that probably was the one thing he'd be walking away going, at least I finished well. You know, scored brilliantly, but I controlled the game and finished well, so I can't really complain too much.
140.
I'm not happy if he can have a good scoring leg, maybe a 12 darter, big finish or something, just to round it off. Sometimes that dispels quite a lot of what's happened before.
59.
Great visit after the first dart there from the Asp.
52. He's looking to try and do it in this leg after the disappointment
52.
In the previous one. 5 missed match darts.
140.
2 big trebles per visit.
Yep. 96 after 9.
81.
There's a look of resignation on Dirk van Dijvenbode's face as he trudges back from the board. As Nathan Aspinall still waiting.
48.
Well, he's going to have to burn another dart to get to a match dart, but it's going to be a chance to win it.
Yeah, good scoring leg from him, but just a little bit sloppy there at the end.
48.
This is for the win. Getting himself ready, focused.
Game shot.
And finally, Nathan Aspinall gets over the line and books his place in the quarterfinals. Dirk van Dijvenbode battled bravely, but just did not have the firepower to worry Nathan Aspinall tonight. The Asp through to the quarters, and he'll face Daryl Gurney for a semi-final berth.
The world match play champion Nathan Aspinall has eased his way past the big Dutchman Dirk van Dijvenbode to book his spot in the Masters quarterfinals, where he'll meet Daryl Gurney tomorrow afternoon. Well, from one leg all, Nathan raced to a 5-1 lead. He went 7-2 up with a 1-2-5 checkout and took out 110 for 8-4, winning 10-5 in the end with an 86 average, Dirk 82. And Dirk will continue to work his way back from that shoulder problem in some poor form, not having won a match since the Grand Slam until this tournament. But now it is time for us to see the world champion and the world number one, Luke Humphries. He's up next against one of the other form players at the back end of last year in Stephen Bunting. He's battle-hardened after his comeback win over Ross Smith last night. He trailed 5-2 at one point, but reeled off the last four legs in a row to book his spot this evening. Let's get them both out with John McDonald.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the action. We are coming to you live on ITV3 from Milton Keynes. And this is the second round action of the Kazoo Masters, brought to you by the Professional Darts Corporation. And now, ladies and gentlemen, for the thousands joining us live and the millions joining us around the world, it's time to meet the players. Both players are from England. Firstly, would you please welcome a World Championship semi-finalist. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of three PDC titles, here's the former Lakeside champion. Time to meet the Bullet, Stephen Bunting. Finals winner. Ladies and gentlemen, he is the reigning champion of the world. Come on, Luke Humphries.
For a place against Peter Wright in tomorrow afternoon's quarter-final. Chris Mason and Stuart Pike will talk us through it.
Well, I'm sure it, well, it does speak it to him, sends shivers down his spine each time since he won it that he's announced as the new world number one and the champion of the world. And he has handled himself superbly since he won it. Of course, all the spotlight was on Luke Littler and his incredible Roy of the Rovers run to the final. And this is the man that got it done. And in my mind, hasn't had all the credit that he deserves. He was phenomenal, he has been phenomenal. And he is a champion in every sense of the word, on and off the hockey. Stephen Bunting, fabulous comeback, wasn't it? 5-2 down to Ross Smith, somehow turned it around, and here he is taking on the world champ. This will be played at a beautiful pace, and it'll be a terrific watch. Humphrey's the favourite, so he should be. But we're underway. The winner to take on Peter Wright in the quarter-final.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. First leg.
Say about boxing, don't they? Styles make fights. Game well. On. Rhythm and tempo in our sport tends to deliver a cracker. There's no reason the form Bunting has shown in recent months, current form of Humphreys, he should have a bit of a barnstormer.
60.
Yeah, Bunting was in great form as well, wasn't he, until he came a cropper at the hands of Michael Van Gerwen at the World Championship. But
60.
I honestly believe Humphreys hasn't had the credit he deserves.
Well, but he is
a poster boy for the sport, Chris.
Yeah, but he's the ultimate professional, and even, you know, in those situations where they're talking about him being world champion, and the chat goes to inevitably Luke Littler.
140.
He just deals with it really well. He's just a real nice guy. Now, the point touched was the score. Yeah, it didn't show up, Bunting, against MDG in that tie in the Worlds. Although MDG was irresistible at times in that one, and he just never let him into the game.
No. He went out with he was a man on a mission that night, wasn't he, Van Gerwen?
Yeah.
How about this, though?
96.
He's making this first leg difficult for the world champ on throw. So Bunting here,
96.
Courtesy of the 180,
Stephen, required 40.
With a chance to win the opener in 13.
Well, this version of Luke Humphreys
game shot
doesn't panic.
Stephen Bunting.
The
second leg,
early version of Luke in game matches on. That if he went a couple of legs behind, he'd start to get annoyed, and then that would affect his performance levels. And as we saw in that final, and he could have gone 5-2 down, but there was barely a flicker from him. You could see he was getting a little frustrated. But once he won that set to make it 4-3, he literally just went through the gears, as he did in winning his three other major tournaments.
Before this game really gets going, I've got to ask you about this spat with Peter Wright that's occurred.
I don't know where it's come from.
He's had a go at you, basically 60. Saying that Dobie should have been in the Premier League.
No, I was asked. I was asked to do my Premier League picks,
yeah.
And I actually put him in it because I knew they'd pick him. But I said I would have put Dobie in personally. I thought he had a good debut campaign. He's currently seventh throughout the whole of 2023 statistically. So the seventh best player. Peter Wright's 34th, finished bottom of the Premier League, and it was just an opinion. There was nothing. There was no. Listen, I put him in my world's top 10 of all time.
Double 10 for 2-0.
90.
Well, no, I think you're absolutely right, and you're able to have an opinion. I think Peter Wright wanted to take it out on someone, and
104.
I'm not. Listen, I understand his frustration because his game's not where he wants it to be.
Matt wrong with an opinion. Matt wrong with Stephen Bunting finishing as he doubles his lead.
96.
And he has the world in his hands, doesn't he, Luke Humphreys? Genuine superstar.
100.
Yeah, I think everything's just been probably a bit bonkers for him since winning, and he's just not been able to sort of apply himself like he would, and being world champion must come with its own pressures, and you've got to carry those pressures.
Well, of course, he was
57.
A special guest, wasn't he, at the top of the show on Friday night here at Milton Keynes.
100.
Spoke really well. But he stayed around afterwards. Yeah. In the media room, there is a board. There's actually no line. It's just a board which has been put up for fun. Well, Bunting's having fun. Boy, is he ever. 114.77. And he sort of measured out roughly where he was going to throw from, and was practicing on this
87.
Muck around, play around.
164.
This is a bit of a role reversal from the last time they met. The last time they did meet, it was Humphreys producing a monster average.
160. Wow. Luke required 38.
Is he straight for it? He normally splits Humphreys.
22. Stephen, you require 48.
I'm surprised at that, to be honest with you.
It's his first two darts at a double.
And again, the 180 from Bunting. Double 10 for 3-0.
No score.
Just the wrong side of the wire.
Luke requires 60.
Game well, no mistake this one. Time.
Luke Humphreys.
But Bunting have two Fulton for 3-0.
They Game met on. Last July in the European match play in a round of 16, and Humphreys had 109 average in a 6-3 win over Bunting, who averaged 95-87. 6-1-80s and 60% on the doubles. That day for Luke Humphreys. Bunty continues to play at this level. 81. He's going to need something similar.
Incredible to believe it's only the third time that Humphreys has been here.
Yeah. 135.
At the Masters, seems to have been around for ages.
And it was.
He was reaching world championship quarterfinals as an unknown, wasn't he?
Yes.
And then he won the World Youth Championship.
Well, he's just made those steady increments of improvement and sort of ticking off all the things that you need to do en route to becoming world champion. He's completed it now.
Yeah.
What a start to this match.
Both players averaging well into the hundreds.
Brilliant.
Game shot.
Breathtakingly brilliant
Stephen
from Bunting. What a start. 3-1, 111 average Stephen Bunting. He ain't messing around.
60.
Well, I've seen performances like this from Bunting towards the back end of 2023.
Worth reminding you, there's his winning legs, 13, 13 and 12, that he survived match dart, didn't he, as well against...
Yep. Well, it was the only
Ross Smith.
Only dart double Ross Smith missed in the whole match.
Double 15. As you say, Humphreys won't panic here. Nevertheless, you feel he needs to win this leg, otherwise it will be a double break of throw. But when he's buzzing, Bunting is dangerous.
100.
Even though his darts are feather light, he throws a hard dart, doesn't he?
Aggressive
throw to the ball.
He's gone up 50%.
140.
From 12 grams to 18 grams. Good job Ryan Searle didn't do that. I don't think they'd reach the board. He wouldn't have a run-up.
Well, he wouldn't be able to hold the darts.
97.
Last one.
Luke required 117.
Tops it is.
Game shot.
We don't rule out Luke Humphries. Brilliant finish. A 117 from the world champ. What a game this is. Humphries averaging 103, Bunting 109. Fabulous stuff. Bunting with the advantage. 3-2. Promise you something special. Stephen Bunting and Luke Humphries are delivering. Brilliant finish from Bunting to open up a 3-1 lead, but a 1-1-7 finish from Luke Humphries in the last leg before that break makes it 3-2. The only break of throw so far coming in the opening leg of the match from Stephen Bunting. He's hit 2-13 darters and a 12 darter in his winning legs. First to 10 to take on Peter Wright in the quarterfinals. And I say Humphries 103, Bunting nearly 109 on the averages. 4-180s already. And as good as we, well, I was going to say thought, but also hope. This is just a great watch.
Yeah, these two just relish the opportunity of just playing darts that allows you to be in almost the rhythm you would have whilst practicing.
140.
Both like to get on with it. And that's being reflected in the performance levels from both. And I think that was a massive last leg of that mini session in 15 for Luke. 4-1. Paint a slightly different picture.
Yeah.
16 in the world at the moment.
60.
If it stays like that, these two could be playing each other quite a lot as the year goes on. World number one, world number 16, but I think Bunting's on the up, isn't he? That'll,
yeah,
he'll go a lot higher than that.
140.
Well, his stats for the year suggest certainly in and around the top 10.
100. Stephen, you require 164.
Way ahead in this leg.
92.
When you come out, you have the darts after a break. Sometimes it can affect the concentration and the rhythm. So for Bunting, it was all
95.
About, doesn't matter how
Stephen
many darts it takes,
72.
Just winning this leg. At the moment, he looked to be breezing to it.
60.
Yeah, just looking at the seasonal numbers, Humphries seasonal average 98.76.
Double six should be a guide.
Bunting in the second half of 2023, very close to Luke's number, 97.14.
121.
Well, there were two or three situations at the Ali Pali in his run to becoming world champion that
96.
He had to dig himself out of a hole, then a bigger hole, then an even bigger hole, but on each occasion Luke Littler did it.
That's the 45. Confidence you get from winning majors. That's the belief. You may think you can do it, but when you actually do it, when you're then put back in that situation, you think, well, I've been here,
50.
I've got the t-shirt.
But it's worth reminding, of course we all know that epic final at the Ali Pali when he beat Luke Littler.
177.
Brilliant again from Humphries, the 177. But in the Grand Prix, the Grand Slam and the Players' Championship Finals, he beat Gavin Price, Rob Cross and Michael van Gerwen. All these tournaments have taken some winning.
57. Look to require 158.
Every tournament within the PDC takes some winning. You look at those European tours and the amount that Dave Chisholm has won, you think, oh, surely a run in one of the big TV tournaments can't be far away. It's playing the same players.
180. Look to require 60.
Pressure from Bunting.
Again, the 180
has opened the door. He was way out of this leg, wasn't he? Again.
Back on 290. Now he's going to get a double 16.
Game shown. Wow.
180 followed by 110 finish. Wow, Stephen Bunting. He was nowhere near 290 in six darts. Humphreys missing two. Got a different look about it now, hasn't it?
97.
This version of Bunty last 6 months or so just looks so likely.
180.
Three 180s each and 177. We've had three top plus finishes.
83.
Humphreys averaging around about 100, Bunting 103.
54.
But a chance here for Humphreys maybe to get one of those breaks to throw back.
145.
Ooh, trouble 15. Yes, tops.
Game shot the eighth.
Wow, what a game we are having. Humphreys. 145 finish from Humphreys. He's taken down 117. We've seen a 130 and a 110 from Bunting. The world champ is coming to the party.
He's starting to move through the gears himself now. Approaching the
57.
Middle part of the match. At worst, he wants to get out of this at 6-4. He'd love to get out at 5-5.
Oh, that would be brilliant, wouldn't it? He's finally broken the Bunting throw, but needs to do it again.
100.
We're all just having a little breather here. That's how good it's been. Well, go on then. Gets another one, he's level.
140. Look to require 164.
Said we were having a breather and not letting us.
Sensible.
132.
Sit back and enjoy.
It's just been played at such a wonderful pace. So easy on the eye, isn't
Luke
it?
Luke required 32. Game shot the ninth leg.
Back to back legs for Humphreys. Now this is a big one. As you say, from
Stevenson throw first. Game on.
From 5-2 down. If he can get it level.
You can see Stephen, who was
averaging well over 110 in parts 30. Of this match, is down to under a ton. And Humphries has been maintaining more or less.
100.
Look at that catastrophic drop in levels.
Back in business.
140.
This is a key leg though.
Huge.
It really is.
Put it this way.
100.
If Luke can find a way to win this leg, the 3 minutes will be a lot more enjoyable in the break for him than it will be for Bunting.
180.
Just when you thought he was slipping. 180s in this match already.
59.
Yeah, so he thought he was slipping. He slips in a fourth max.
Means a lot, doesn't he, really?
Yeah. Just to try and apply a bit of pressure. Needs another. Gets
134.
Another.
134.
Fingers crossed
Seating
job
required 51.
For Luke and his fans.
34.
Humphries was going to come racing back. Bunting halts him in some style. Really good hold of throw. A little nod of approval there from Stephen Bunting. We've got a game on. Humphries, the world champ, has it all to do. Bunting leading 6 legs to 4. Saturday night at the Masters in Milton Keynes, and the world champ has some work to do against Stephen Bunting. Coming up next, Michael van Gerwen against Chris Dovey. Of course, Dovey is the defending champion. And Michael van Gerwen won 5 consecutive Masters titles between 2015 and 2019, but not reached the final since. That'll be worth staying for. Just a reminder as well, by the way, that the quarterfinals on Sunday afternoon and then the semi-finals and finals Sunday night, the darts will be back on ITV4. Bunting leading 6-4, with Humphries only one break
11
behind.
Player gets Luke to throw first. Game on.
But this is very good.
Yeah, it's what we certainly hoped for. But this is a huge 85. Leg and they'll both be pleased to know there'll be no further interruptions in this one. Played to a winner. And it's all about who gets back into the groove the quickest.
100.
Persisted. Got his treble in the end.
100.
Pretty impressive, isn't it?
Yeah, only 2 legs in the entire match, requiring a sixth turn. What a game of darts.
140!
A good response from Humphries. Everything he's touched has turned to gold over the last 3 or 4 months. He'd love to add the Masters to his roll of honour, but Stephen
91.
Bunting at the moment, you've got to say, deserving to be in front.
Absolutely.
85. Stephen, you require 170.
We had a few attempts yesterday, didn't we? A
couple today as well.
Yep.
Last time he did this, he managed to get a treble with the last
60.
Dart.
60. Luca Require 91.
A bit better serve going for the ball. He needed the treble 17. Well, he's hit two wrong trebles. How unlucky. Treble 14 would have left him top.
You know what Bunty can do.
59.
110.
Done it already.
Stephen Require, yeah, like 110. Seven.
If he does it this time, he'll have to be a different route.
Game shot, the 11th player.
Sensational from Bunting. There is no stopping him.
Top player gets Stephen to throw first.
It is Luke Humphreys going to be his name added to a role of honour that he doesn't want. Of world champions who've come to the Masters and lost in the first round. So far, Gary Anderson, who lost to Vincent van der Voort. Peter Wright also defeated by Simon Whitlock. That was in 2022.
85.
Three ton plus finishes. Blooming heck.
Five in the match. What a chance this is for Humphreys to break back and close the gap to just two.
96.
And then really try and get on a bit of a charge.
It'll be non-stop for the likes of Humphreys for most of the year. Next port of call, Berlin, Mike 2 of the Premier League.
100.
Are you doing that one, Stu?
Glasgow. Should be.
Humphreys.
Remember that stunning comeback in the final of the Players' Championship against Michael van Gerwen when he looked down and out. You never, ever write him off. 5-1 80s.
85. Yeah,
he reeled off four on the spin, wasn't it?
40.
Not going to be another big finish, is it?
Game shot, wow.
145, 140, 117 from Humphreys. 130, 110, 110 from Bunting. Six ton plus finishes. Half the legs in this match have been won with big finishes.
59.
But then a poor start from the world champ on his throne.
That will just add to the 100. Obvious frustrations he'll be feeling.
134.
That was a feature of his run to winning the World Championship, yep, as well. The amount of times that he came down for the treble 19 and hit them with two.
100.
The strike rate on the cover shots in that Worlds was quite remarkable.
98.
Entirely happy with how he's playing at the moment, despite averaging 101.5.
He hasn't been ahead at any stage in this match, Luke Humphreys.
No, he's been chasing from the
96.
Off, hasn't he?
Yeah,
I'll tell you what, though, he's settled for this going to a last leg decider.
Not many.
75.
Just being made to work extremely hard by Stephen Bunting here. So he's finding it tough to get into that real natural
100.
Luke throw
Require,
because he's just being made to force a little.
Double 14 for another stunning finish.
121.
And every time Humphreys has had an opportunity, Bunting has come back and finished a big ton plus finish to win the leg. Can he do it again?
Oh, this would sting.
Well, he changed his mind and he's now going for double 16.
89. Luca Require, 14.
Straight for it. Well, can he see a way through?
Game,
oh, what a dart! What Luke a dart! You can see by the reaction of Luke Humphreys' face there.
How on earth? Look where it went.
I think that was one of those where you just sort of shut your eyes and just throw and hope.
140.
Wow. And he does have this quite looping dart, and he's able to somehow manufacture 58. Up a way of crashing in and around what appear to us as complete blockers.
Take
something very special to beat the bunting here. 140, 140.
60.
Be strong on throw. Be into the quarters, Stephen Bunting.
And just when Luke starts to have a bit of hope, Bunting keeps producing
100.
High quality legs.
6-1-18.
Seeming to require 121.
But he's still way off.
81.
Brilliant.
Tops after 12. Forcing Humphreys to produce a 12 of his own to win the leg. As you could see, after 9,
seeming
he was back.
40.
Way back in the 200s.
Even Bunting, who came from 5-2 down and out against Ross Smith,
game shot,
survived a match start.
Stephen Bunting, 15 play
on Friday night.
Play
and he's 8-6 up against the world champ.
Two away from a win over world number one and world champion, who, well, it has to be said, he's playing very well, averaging a ton.
'96. 140.
I keep telling himself he's running out of legs.
Yeah.
Just one break of throw.
He'll be just saying to himself, just keep him away from getting to a ninth leg.
Yeah.
That's what you tend to do when you're playing catch up.
58.
Very little to choose between them in every metric we look at.
140.
No, it's been, the quality's been outstanding.
100.
Interesting there, Bunting just taking a breather.
100. Luke to require 81.
11 darter.
Game shot the 15 player.
Superb from
Humphreys.
Just such a beautiful leg, wasn't it?
First. Game on.
He needs another one here.
Yes.
97.
He just keeps niggling away, yep, doesn't he?
He just doesn't. It's just not giving him any. No. Any time to relax.
139.
If Humphreys wins this leg, then different perception.
100.
Still an opportunity here for Luke.
135.
Stolen the darts.
99.
Last dart again.
Twice in the leg.
World champion darts.
140.
He's left 87. This time after 9, the last leg it was 81. Can he find an 11 darter to level this game? Don't forget, Bunting missed one dart for 8-5, didn't he?
59. Luke to require 87.
87. Bullseye.
62.
Had to go for it.
Yeah, well, the way the 10 plus finishes have been popping in.
Couldn't take the risk. And Bunting's proved he's more than capable of finding something special. And again, he's slowing it down, isn't he? Had a drink, put the darts in his pocket, wiped his brow, wiped his hands. Stepping up to have a crack at 146. He cannot do this. He cannot do this. He just can't. He can't do that, Stephen Bunting. Incredible. Absolutely incredible.
77.
No wonder Luke Humphries was shaking his head.
Every time he's got within touching distance, Bunting produces.
Can we play that again just to make sure he did it? Look at that. That is a... He was out of the leg. Totally out of the leg. Humphries felt compelled to go for the ball on 87.
I was about to say, I'm not sure this is the right sort of tactic from Bunting.
59.
He's taking himself out of that rhythm, but... Couldn't have been more wrong. Looks like he's had the stuffing hit out of him. He'd be human if he wasn't feeling like this just isn't meant to be my night.
Well, that's just unreal.
60.
Four ton plus finishes, but all of them have been to win legs where Humphries has had opportunities or is waiting to win them.
40.
Yeah, he had a dart there at the ball, didn't he, off the, yeah, the back of 87.
And it's not going for him here.
And that would have been for a...
eight all.
Yeah.
Well,
Luke Humphries has played superbly.
134.
Those numbers picking that up.
I still can't believe that finish.
121.
Took a deflection there, you could hear it.
97.
Well, this is easy. This is easy, surely. He could do this with his eyes closed.
Steven, you require 146,
130, 110, 110.
The old Shanghai should be a piece of cake.
100. Luke, you require 94.
Stay in the tournament. You went double-double on the double 19.
38.
And that 146 finish from Humphries must have thought, I'm coming back for 8-all. But Stephen Bunting here for a sensational win and a sensational performance. And it would be a place in the quarterfinals.
Wow.
But he's missed three match starts.
56.
I was packing my gear away.
Thank you.
16 for tops, possibly.
Why are they booing? Ridiculous. Oh, dearie me.
21, that last dart's in pound, you're over the hockey. Stephen, you require five.
The last dart won't count because he was on the hockey before he threw it. Is that right?
Yep, correct from Charlie.
20.
Stephen Bunting beats the world champion. What a performance, what a game. And Stephen Bunting hit four ton plus finishes to keep the world champ at bay. That was exceptional from the bullet. And he's through to the quarterfinals to take on Peter Wright. Luke Humphries didn't do too much wrong, beaten by the better man. And Bunting pressed for a first big PDC title. Remains on track, 10-7 winner.
Well, we've just been treated to the most thrilling match of the tournament so far. World champion, world number one, Luke Humphries, knocked out by an outstanding performance from Stephen Bunting. And Stephen will meet Peter Wright tomorrow afternoon in the Masters quarterfinals. What a game that was. Entertainment everywhere you looked. And look at the 10 plus finishes there. 4 for Stephen, 3 for Luke. Really high quality encounter. 99 average for Luke, who was absolutely fuming again due to some whistling at the end, just as he was in Cardiff on Thursday night. He's absolutely devastated to be out, but angry at the same time. 10 maximums between them in that match. Well, let's have a listen to what Stephen Bunting has to say in reflection on his victory. He's with Dan.
Stephen, congrats. What a game of darts. Big finishes flying in all over the place, but the 1-4-6 was probably the crucial one, wasn't it?
Yeah, no, definitely. I knew that if you give me a chance, even in the back room, finishes were flying in, and it proved vital there. And obviously, when you're playing the world champion, world number one, you need to produce your best.
The support you have from the crowd, I mean, is it surprising you how much support you have? I mean, they made it difficult for Luke at the end. There's some whistling, but it's all something you've got to deal with as a player.
Yeah, no, of course. I mean, I tried to calm the crowd down there at the end. No one wants to win a game like that. Obviously, it was a great game, and I want to win playing as well as I can, and if he plays his best, he'll win. So, yeah, like I said, I tried to calm it down, but the crowd's been unreal ever since the Worlds and the Grand Prix, the Grand Slam. Everything's been phenomenal. The Let's Go Bunting mental strikes again, eh?
It really does. You're arguably the form player in this half of the draw. You must be feeling so good about your chances of going further than ever before in this tournament.
Yeah, no, I'll keep taping a Lemsip and keep making sure that I have an early night and I'll be ready again for tomorrow. But yeah, I feel really good, honestly. In the practice room, is I don't know what the averages were there, but in the practice room, I was playing unbelievable stuff. Missed a few nine darters, 180s flying in. The new target darts are going fantastic, and I can't wait for them to come out in September.
Long may it continue. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yes, we'll see him against Peter Wright tomorrow afternoon. Well done, Stephen. He's through along with Nathan Aspinall. Michael Smith and Dimitri Vandenberg still to come. But first, it's Michael van Gerwen, who's won 5 Masters titles here in Milton Keynes, against Chris Dobie, the champion from 12 months ago. The quality just keeps on coming. Here's John McDonald.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the second round action of the Kazoo Masters, brought to you by the Professional Darts Corporation and coming to you live on ITV3 from Milton Keynes. Time to meet the players. From England, the winner of 3 PDC titles, he is the reigning and defending Masters champion, Hollywood Chris. And gentlemen, from the Netherlands, the winner of 153 PDC titles worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of 21 World Series titles. He's a 5-time Masters champion and a 3-time champion of the world. Mighty Michael.
Only Michael van Gerwen has successfully defended his Masters title. Can Chris Dovey follow in his footsteps? He has a big old job on his hands if he's to do it. Let's see. Mark and Dan will guide us through this one.
Yes, it is a big job, but Chris Dovey is better equipped than ever to do it. It is the defending champion versus the five-time champion MVG. Dovey inside the world's top 16. And remember, this title that he is currently holding is not a ranking event. So he's in the top 16 without any money earned from his Masters win 12 months ago. It is no mean feat for Hollywood to be up there. Tournament average, well, he's only played the one game, but he's actually averaged more than that over the whole last 12 months. He's been such an in-form player, but mighty Michael van Gerwen, the five-time champion. 5 years since he won this title. That is a long old wait for MVG, for any title. And he will be desperate to get his hands back on it. Fresh from winning in what is basically his backyard in the World Series in Den Bosch, just down the road from where he lives in Vlaemen. So we'll have some confidence, but when does he not have confidence, Mark Webster? He believes, even though he's not been top of the rankings for a long old while, that he's the best player in the world, and if he plays his game, he wins.
Yeah, that's always the Michael van Gerwen approach, isn't it? As he lost his first game in Cardiff 100. On Thursday evening. That will happen a few more times in the Premier League. We've seen how Michael pans out in the Premier League. He knows how to get to playoff night, and 100. He won't be beating himself up too much about that defeat. He'll be good to go here. And you correctly said, Dan, looking to get his hands on a trophy that hasn't won for a while. Five successive wins, and there's been a bit of a barren spell in the Masters, but will always back himself, Michael van Gerwen. And Chris Dovey, he's got a serious threat.
121.
Well, it was a magnificent World Championship campaign from Chris Dovey. And he ended in that heartbreaking defeat to Rob Cross. 4-0 up, lost 5-4. But when he suffered setbacks in the past, he's gritted his teeth, got down to business, and got better. And he has been getting better for some time.
That's for a confident hold a throw.
69.
Take it there, won't be too concerned. Yeah, I echo that. Chris Dovey said at the top of the show, he's not a sulker when he loses matches, and he's had some heartbreaking defeats. 69. He just gets on with it. Rob
12.
Cross, a couple of occasions, it's made him a stronger player, and he'll hope that that heartbreak at the World Championship will make him stronger. Bit of a flyer there, though. This could get messy, this opening leg. Ah, game good composure there. No one likes double three, but he went straight at it. Dovey holds.
Yeah, excellent start from Chris Dovey.
96.
Was unable to beat MVG in their first 11 meetings. But as I mentioned, he's got better. Finally broke his hoodoo by beating him at the European Championship. A game he should have won comfortably and had to survive match darts.
96.
But since that point, it's been a lot more even. And that's partly down to Dovey being better, and it's partly down to van Gerwen not being as dominant 96. A force as he was at his very peak, obviously.
Yeah, of course, nine meetings in 2023. Van Gerwen just edged it. There were some one-sided affairs on both of them. Dovey winning 6-0 in the Premier League. It was a 5-0 win for Michael at the World Championship. Correctly said, though, Dan, it's been a lot more competitive. So this new version of Chris Dovey for me that's
43.
Appeared since that defeat to Rob Cross in the match play just under 2 years ago, made a sterner step.
I mean, of all of the performances that Dovey has put in to 57. Beat MVG, and there's five of them, the most recent one at the World Grand Prix, full five sets, double start, where he outplayed MVG. That's,
81.
In my opinion, probably the most impressive.
Another set play. Tough nut to crack, Michael van Gerwen. Both. So Chris Dovey lost out in the quarterfinals at the Worlds. Michael van Gerwen later on that day went out in the World Championship, and it was a shock defeat to Scott Williams, and you haven't seen that performance coming. Steady start to the year, runner-up in Bahrain, winner in Den Bosch. And Premier League campaign, nothing. No points yet, but it's week one.
Good-looking first start from Dovey.
And we saw all the way through the World Championship that he is right up there with the heaviest hitters in the scoring department nowadays. And it's in the 16, so the chance is gone.
What a nine left. Sorry. After the 17, go for.
Chris, you require 109.
It's 109 left for Dobie.
Trouble 19 for double 16. Can't get it. And that was a
57. Michael
half
Eva
chance
Klein,
for Dobie to get a break of throw.
Games on the second leg.
Michael holds comfortably Michael levels at the match.
Third leg, Christopher Fizz. Game on.
Already mentioned on more than one occasion this weekend about Chris Dobie winning this title 56. Last year and the route he had to take. It was not easy at all. The players that he beat come through and take the title.
97.
Cullen, Humphreys, Dirk van Dijven, Bodo, Michael Smith and then Rob Cross. I mean, with the nature of this tournament, you know the field is going to be high quality.
60. A big fortnight that for Chris Dobie, winning the event here, then he was quickly told he was in the Premier League the morning after. He went and won night one, beating Michael Van Gogh in the final in Belfast last year.
134.
Van Gogh pushing on the Dobie throw here.
134.
Crafting an opportunist.
Against the throw as well. You expect minimum doubt the balls are here for Michael Van Gogh.
99. Michael, you require 90.
Goes the aggressive route. Goes ball first. That's a brilliant leg. 11 darts. First break of throw. Michael Van Gogh in leads. No reaction. Knows it's early in the match. He knows what Chris Dobie's capable of, but he's 2 from 2 on the doubles.
42. Would have
probably stayed down. It had the second down not been hanging by a thread in the treble 19. An early change of target in the leg from Michael.
60.
Very different game this one for Chris Dobie than his game against Andrew Gilding, where he did find enough good stuff to win it, but he admitted that the pace of the game did not allow him to feel comfortable and get into a rhythm. He knew
43.
That it would be more suitable for in this game. Unfortunately for him, it goes hand in hand with playing one of the greatest players that's ever lived.
134.
We spoke a lot about Chris Dobie recovering from setbacks. Michael as well, Bahrain, the final against Luke Littler, really underperformed. And it was a case, right, let's go 40. Again next
Michael,
week.
You require 112.
The opposite way around, he kind of laboured to the final, then produced his best stuff in the final. And he's had that setback at Cardiff.
32.
Looking to right the wrongs here. He's got an early advantage, Michael.
It's a poor visit from MVG there, but it's one that he can probably afford to have. He definitely
57.
Can. Probably back on nearly 300 80. And not putting any dent in it at all. This is a comfortable leg.
40.
Oh, too comfortable. Be back again. So good opening hold of throw, Dobie. He's not offered a great deal since.
100. Michael, you require 40.
3 legs on the spin now for MVG.
This is already an important leg for Chris. What about slow start to the match?
57.
The first leg was good, wasn't it? And then there's been very little to follow.
Michael, without being anywhere near his best, is going on the hunt for a 4-1 lead and a double break.
fair to say, this is not the start of the game we expected. 19 and 21 darts for MVG to hold his throw in the early exchanges here. Brilliant 11 darter chucked in there as
100.
Well.
100.
Probably just can't find anything after that opening leg. Averaging around about 77.
100.
Some early damage being done here by Michael.
100. Michael, you require 130.
No need to go for this on the bullseye.
Too comfortable at the back end of the legs. He's done that a couple of times now, Dan. The setup's not been great, but he's probably going to get away with it. Dolby not there to strike. And
56.
Strange performance from Chris. You don't often see this from him. He's a pretty quick out the blocks normally.
Double nine.
69.
It turns out you can afford some mistakes. Quite a few of them. Chris Dovey is not really applying any pressure at all.
100. Michael, you require 18.
And gearing three in hand for 4-1. Could be awkward. Gets there in the end. And, yeah, clenched fist. The shake of the head that he knows he's not at his best, but this is cruise control. Dovey started well winning the opening leg, but it's been all Michael van Gerwen. An average of less than 87, but it's cruise control for van Gerwen. He leads by 4-1.
Welcome back to the Masters in Milton Keynes, where the defending champion, Chris Dovey, the title defence is not quite going according to plan. He's only won one of the first five legs against the five-time champion, Michael van Gerwen, and the winner through to the quarterfinals tomorrow afternoon, the final day of the tournament, from 12:45 on ITV4 tomorrow. MVG needing six more legs to book his place there, and it is Dave Chisnall, the world number 10, who awaits. He's played some excellent stuff so far this weekend as Chizzy, the two-time finalist.
Chris Dovey, plenty to ponder. No surprise, he stayed up in that break on stage, practising. Just can't find rhythm here.
60.
Very unlike Chris Dovey. Fear for him at this stage.
99.
Well, right now he's averaging just over 77. If it stays at that, that's his lowest ever average on telly, and that includes a World Grand Prix, which is double star. It's not going to stay at those numbers.
60.
It's going to get back up to more normal levels of performance, you would expect. However, he's already conceded a big advantage to MVG, who's not playing brilliantly himself.
That's the key point, Dan. He's not playing brilliant, is he? But still finds himself 4-1 in front. So whilst Chris Dovey will get better, you're expecting Michael van Gerwen to get better.
Is he going for it? Looks a good guide. Well,
93.
It might have been, but he got nowhere near it.
Don't need to go for it. And again, time at the back end of a leg. This is for the fifth consecutive leg. Reminder, Dovey won the opener. Double A.
34.
Michael has missed 10 darts at doubles. Dovey's not keeping himself straight and staying in the legs.
121.
It's not just that
Michael
Dovey hasn't won a leg since the first leg. He hasn't had a dart at double since that first leg. So James van Gerwen can keep leg. On missing doubles Michael as much as he wants, because he's got all the time in the world.
Wait. to the quarterfinals. Dave Chisnell waits.
57.
He was our first confirmed quarterfinal. He's won the opening match of the day against Danny Noppert.
140.
There's a little smirk from MVG when that last dart found the target.
100.
I mentioned it about Chris Dobie dusting himself down. If this match doesn't go his way, it's not looking likely at the minute. He will just literally put it down to just one of them performances. Just one of them. And we'll go again. Spear him on a little bit. Competitive in a leg for the first time in a while in the match.
67. Chris, you require 164.
Can he back it up with another perfect visit? And the answer is no. And he's missed the bullseye entirely. He's gone into the two segment.
41. Michael, you require 154.
This is not good. Maybe relevant. Tops.
Game.
It's a six consecutive leg. Everything's going Michael Van Gerwen's way. And Chris Dobie, he's getting that sinking feeling. He'll keep chipping away, but it's a big task. He's averaging less than 80, 6-1 down in a race to 10 against the former five-time champion. And it looks like we're going to lose the defending champion here in Milton Keynes.
And that will mean that MVG remains the only player to successfully defend his Masters title. There aren't many former champions left in the field, of course. These two, obvious former winners of it. Peter Wright's still in, although he'll have to improve significantly on what we've seen, not just today and this weekend, but in recent months. Clayton Cullen both gone. Wade gone, and Phil Taylor hasn't been in this for some time.
93.
Decent switch just to round it off. Build to the start down the bottom of the board. It's focused on a lot of negative the way Chris Dobie's performed. Just to run you through some of the stuff he achieved 95. In 2023. Quarterfinals, the Worlds, the match play, the Grand Prix, won the Masters, seventh in the Premier League, and I feel that was a bit unjust.
96.
It was a great year. Quarterfinalist again at the World Championship, up in the top 16 in the world. And again, down a point you made earlier. He didn't, this wasn't even ranking money to help him get to that top 16 when he won this 12
Michael
months ago.
114.
Looks like he's just falling short here. Van Gerwen for 7-1.
94.
Chris Dobie is going to get his first dart at double since leg one, or he should do. It will only be one. It's a double 16.
36. Michael, you've acquired 20.
5-10.
I'm
happy with that dart, Michael. Just wants to get this done. Dobie for a glimmer of hope here. It's against the darts as well.
Game
stops the rot.
Yeah.
No real
Chris
celebration.
Dobie.
There was never going to be.
Ninth leg,
just offers
Chris
a little opportunity. Just never
on.
Know. A hold here, then a break, and all of a sudden it's 6-4 at the next break.
57.
Yeah, 6-4, he'll feel like he's got a chance. 7-3, it's difficult. 8-2 would feel like a lost cause going into the final session.
140.
It's more like it.
140.
Signs of improvement slowly, Dobie. Like we said, get in after this mini session at 6-4.
134.
I just don't know. We thought Peter Wright was cruising this afternoon, and he got embroiled.
And let's be honest, the early stages of that game, Peter Wright 81. Was playing better than Michael Van Gerwen is playing here.
134.
Dobie way back again.
140. Michael, you've applied 93.
This against the Dhobi Darts. Gets the treble, double 18. Is found. Beautiful finish from Michael van Gerwen to break straight back, take a 7-2 lead. And he has the darts in his hand, looking for 8-2. And while it's not officially curtains, Chris Dhobi will not be feeling particularly optimistic about turning things around from that score.
Right. At all. I mean, when you're on that stage and you're playing these sort of games,
140.
Believe me, I've been in some positions where you feel it's a thankless task, and you just knowing yourself, you're not playing well enough, and you're just hoping more than thinking you can get yourself back in the game.
But it's not like Chris Dhobi's up there playing 57. Not very well and thinking, well, it's happening again. This is an aberration because he's been so good for so long. Not just all those runs on telly you mentioned. Look at the players he's beaten along
99.
The way. Beat MVG at the Grand Prix, beat Michael Smith at the match play, beat Chizzy at the European Championship, beaten big name players, in-form players.
100.
And that's why it looks like Chris Dhobi's going to go on and lose this match. I never say never, but it's a tall order.
57.
If he does, I think it'll just be a case of, right, forget this one. It's a rare poor performance, doesn't happen often. Could be break a throw here.
Double 11 miss. Van Gerwen looking at 150. Tall order, but this is mighty Michael van Gerwen. Not up to the task on this occasion. Dhobi has a decision to make here. Can go straight at it or split it to leave a more favourable double.
He'll go straight at him, sure. With a glimmer of hope. Double four for Dhobi. And he gets the double four, and he's just hanging on in there. The defending champion will keep scrapping. He's well below his best here, averaging in the mid-80s, but won a couple of legs in that session. It's 7-3 in favour of Michael van Gerwen.
Welcome back to the Masters, where Michael van Gerwen, with the standout moment of quality in this last 16 game, a 1-5-4 checkout. That was in the seventh leg to take a 6-1 lead against Chris Dhobi. Now, Hollywood has, I hesitate to say, hit back, but he's managed to get a couple of more legs on the board. The score is MVG 7, Chris Dhobi 3 in a race to 10. And for two guys who have won six Masters titles between them, more than half of the 11 previous stagings of this tournament, it is a game strangely low on quality. But I'm sure that Dhobi, who has had some high-profile cases, including one very recently at the World Championship, where there have been incredible comebacks and he's been on the wrong end of them, he would love to put his name in the history books for being on the right side of one. And this is an opportunity to do that.
93.
Positive you can take from being 7-3 down is it's Michael van Gerwen not at his best, so there is, if he ups it, a slight opportunity.
54.
But you just expect Michael, with obviously all the experience, he's got all the titles he's won, even when not at his best, he should convert a 7-3 lead. Going about it the right way.
You can see there, it's been a real mix of stuff from MVG. There are three four-visit legs in there, 11 and 12 darters, which are absolutely spectacular, but there's been a lot of pretty ropey stuff. The problem Dhobi's got is if van Gerwen finds some more of that gold, he doesn't need much more of it to get over the line.
I feel like the last few years, Michael's accepted, he used to be, want to be spectacular, obsessed with top averages all the time. He's accepted Michael sometimes, it's just about winning the game, and if the performance isn't there, get over the line, and this is one of those scenarios. Still averaging up towards 96 now.
Chris, you require 158.
Yeah, he is judged by different standards, such as his status.
96. Michael, you require 32.
For 8-3. It is 8-3, and if Chris Doby was entertaining hopes of a miraculous comeback, those chances are getting slimmer by the second.
Chris
has managed to break straight back in the last few occasions. The last couple of legs has won.
140.
See what comes of it. And Michael, he just wants to get this done, get himself ready for what he hopes is a busy day tomorrow. Starting with Chizzy. Quarters in the afternoon, semis and final in the evening. A lot of darts to be played on finals day at the Masters.
Yeah, MVG will face Chisholm if he wins this in the same half of the draw. The likes of Damon Hetter, Michael Smith and Dimitri Vandenberg to face off in our final game. That's Michael Smith. It's the top half of the draw, which is the avenue of opportunity.
Michael, you require 129.
Bunting right, Aspinall and Gurney. Treble 20. Can't get it.
89. Chris, you require 87.
Chance of winning the Masters. The subplot of a Grand Slam spot as well. Dolby. Let's find another leg. And does find another leg. He's not going away, Chris. He needs to back it up with a hold here. Keep your opponent two away, as we always say. Still a glimmer of hope for Hollywood.
He's only managed to hold his throw once. That was the very first leg of the match, Chris Doby.
97.
And already Van Gerwen is applying the pressure on Hollywood's throw.
That's
number four for Michael. Got to be patient here, Michael. He knows he's in control. Just don't try and rush to the finish.
98. 140.
He's been good in this final session of the match, MVG. He's dragged his average up past 97 now, and this is a game where it's looked like he's kind of laboured and struggled through it for long periods.
16 darts of doubles in the match as well.
60. Michael, you require 124.
Knows how to deal with these situations. Not 56. Opting for the treble 18.
Chris, you require 150.
96. Well, takes a bite 68. Out of it. MVG might only get one dart at double. No, he will get two. He'll need two.
Games on the 13th
second
leg.
One does the job, and Michael Van Gerwen, the five-time champion, is a leg away from ending Chris Doby's title defence.
Yeah, feels real raw from Michael. He knew if he'd missed that. So all of a sudden, 8-5, there's a possibility of getting embroiled. His foot on the accelerator now, keen to get this wrapped up and get himself ready for the clash with Dave Chisnell.
Tearing off towards the finishing line here, MVG. If there was time to get hold of him in this game, it was early on when he hadn't got into his stride. But as the game has gone on, he's looked more and more comfortable. And this is more like the Michael Van Gerwen we expected from Dart 1.
After five legs, Michael was averaging 86, and you can't find yourself 4-1 down to Michael. That represents a serious opportunity, not just to lead, but to maybe rattle through all five of the legs.
58.
Slow start from Doby's cost him. He'll know where it's gone wrong, and he won't beat himself up too much about it. But Michael looking to wrap it up here. He's not going to do it on this visit.
82.
Well set up. And he may be the defending champions. Last darts in this year's Masters.
So often in this game, he's had such a lead in legs that he's been able to do exactly what he wants. And he's been given opportunity after opportunity to wrap him up. And he does finally get the match in the bag. The five-time champion ends the title defence. Chris Dobie's reign as the Masters champ is over. Michael van Gerwen is looking to win this one again. He is through to the quarterfinals. It'll be MVG versus Dave Chisnall tomorrow afternoon. And there's one spot left available in the last eight. It'll go to Michael Smith, the Bully Boy, or the Dreammaker, Dimitri Vandenberg.
The five-time Masters champion, Michael van Gerwen, is through to finals day once again. He's comfortably dispatched the defending champion, Chris Dobie, 10-4. And we'll be back tomorrow afternoon when he meets Dave Chisnall. Well, it was a rather out-of-sorts performance from Dobie after going 1-0 up. He lost the next five legs in a row and he couldn't turn it around. He averaged 87 tonight, Michael not having to fully extend himself. 96 average in the end, but he was pretty comfortable. Let's hear from him now with Dan.
Michael, congratulations. Relatively straightforward night for you.
I can't complain too much. It wasn't the best, but overall, I can't really complain.
You didn't start the game brilliantly, but Chris was even worse, and you were actually playing well towards the end of the match.
Yeah, end of the game, I think I played some really good darts in patches. But with all due respect, Chris was poorly today, and maybe it was the pressure, maybe the thing, I don't know. But I did what I had to do, and that's the most important thing for myself.
Obviously, he was the defending champion. You know, you're the only person who knows what it's like to walk in here and retain the title. But I would imagine you're keen to win this one back after quite a long wait.
Yeah, I've been waiting a few years for this title, so my eyes aren't sharp this weekend. And I feel comfortable, I feel good. Today was... I was in patches, I was really well, but still too many legs I didn't play good, or I give him the chances, I give him an unnecessary chance to get it back in the game, and you shouldn't put yourself in that position, but who cares, I'm through to the next round.
And it's Dave Chisnall you'll face, Pro Tour Player of the Year. He had a great year last year away from the TV cameras, but you know how dangerous he can be.
He's always dangerous, but he also knows how dangerous I can be always against him. So that's the thing I have to do. I have to play well against him, man. Same as any other opponent you want to beat. Who comes on your path, you have to beat him. Simple as that.
Congratulations. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, that should be a fun quarterfinal. MVG versus Chizzy. And our lineup is almost complete. There is just one quarterfinal space remaining. After a pretty eventful day here in Milton Keynes, it is Michael Smith and Dimitri Vandenberg contesting that very last spot. Let's get them out with John McDonald.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the second round action of the Kazoo Masters, brought to you by the Professional Darts Corporation, coming to you live here on ITV3. Welcome to the great city of Milton Keynes! To meet the players. Ladies and gentlemen, he is Belgium's World Cup star, the winner of the World Match Play and seven PDC titles. He's a two-time back-to-back World Youth Champion, the Dream Maker, Dimitri Vandenberg. Yeah. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from England, the winner of the Grand Slam and three World Series titles. He's the former champion of the world. Let loose the bully boy, Michael Spears.
See an Englishman involved in all four quarterfinals tomorrow. Will Dimitri break the mould and book a spot against the Aussie Damon Hetter? Let's find out now with Alan Warren a little and Stuart Pike.
Yeah, so we will know our full quarterfinal lineup very soon. Dimitri Vandenberg looking very relaxed. He was dancing to his own tune. He was dancing to the Michael Smith walk-on. And here he is. He was too good for James Wade. James Wade was poor. Actually, both players missed 15 darts at double in that game, but Dimitri got it won by 6-1. You can get on with it, you know, Dimitri. You are throwing first. And I'm not quite sure what he's so happy about. We know he's happy, but time to get on with it, old boy. Come on. Yeah, Smith against Vandenberg, winner to play Hetter. Dimitri is looking to reach the quarterfinals of the Masters for the very first time. Michael Smith, of course, buoyed by his success on the opening night of the Premier League. And you have to say, after a difficult year with the world champion badge on his collar, much needed win, huge win for many reasons at Cardiff on Thursday.
Yes, absolutely. It's time to knuckle down again though, isn't it? The season's about to start. Yes, he's played in the Premier League and the two World Series events. Rankin tournament starts a week on Monday. Smith's ninth Masters.
Ladies and gentlemen,
remember when he was runner-up to Peter Wright? I think we commentated on the game and missed a chance to win his first title at that time.
He did, absolutely. It all came good in the end for Michael Smith, but he'll want a really strong 2024.
Well,
the same can be said for Dimitri as well. He needs a boost, a confidence boost, a good win. The Belgian.
57.
Yeah, we've said that a lot of this weekend, haven't we, with certain players, and I think they're all aware of that. That's the important thing. It's all about,
you know,
putting the work in. That's the first port of call. Get your prep right.
Nice.
Some of the events during the season, you don't have to do it in everyone.
Dimitri's also moved back home, hasn't he? And based himself in the UK for a number of years, but now back in Belgium.
14.
How much a family man these days.
Sing.
I suppose depending on where he lives in Belgium, near an airport, as an example, how easy it is to get over to the UK. I mean, as an example, you could be living in Carlisle and having to travel to London. It's probably easier to fly from Belgium. So it's maybe not as difficult, but obviously costly with the flight. So Michael Smith. It's the maximum count underway.
Until this last visit, till the max, Michael Smith totally out of the leg. Oh, double 10.
Yeah, for the first leg,
it's 120 finish, not the way you envisaged, but it doesn't matter.
Especially when your opponent's just piled in a max.
Oh, 84.
Denies him the opportunity to take the leg. Nice 120 finish, 15 darter.
Worth making a point that yet again tonight we've
42.
Unfortunately had to suffer some idiotic whistling from a very small element of the crowd here in Milton Keynes, and it needs to be stamped out, and stamped out quickly. No part in this sport for that sort of behaviour. Just my opinion, but totally out of order.
Yes, I think the crowd can help with that. If they see somebody whistling, tell them to shut up.
Absolutely, or point them out.
We're here to have a good time, watch some world-class darts in a party atmosphere.
I have to stress, it's a few idiots in the crowd.
Mike Lewis, 160.
Yes, our fans are generally pretty good, aren't they?
Yeah.
In the fancy dress, just here, enjoy themselves, enjoy the darts.
Six.
If you're gonna behave like that, what's the point of coming?
56.
But on with the darts, Michael Smith to level, looking at tops. Yeah, we've had 120 from Dimitri, 100 from Michael Smith, and it all augurs well. An astonishing game between Stephen Bunting and Luke Humphries, which featured 7 top plus finishes. Now we're getting a max from Vandenberg.
Yes, this match is starting well. Already seen some quality, a max of pace, as you say. A ton on a 120 finish. Only in leg 3.
97.
For the last place in the quarterfinals tomorrow.
57.
Well, those quarterfinals, Bunting against Wright, Aspinall against Gurney. Michael van Gerwen taking on Dave Chisnell. And the winner of this to play Damon Hetter.
6. Major Uruguay, 84.
With a good leg on throw for Dimitri. Doesn't need to go for the bullseye route, hence he went for the treble 16. With Michael Smith back on 284. So a good scoring leg from Dimitri here.
95. Dimitri Uruguay 32.
A double 16 for a nice little 13 darter.
100. Well, yeah, absolutely.
Michael Smith will just be a bit sore that he was so far behind.
Can't see
him missing again, can you?
Well, at the very least, it would go on the inside. But he managed to hit the double with the first. So, job done.
6.
So, he'll be pretty happy with the start despite that. Missed with 3 darts at the double, but Mike Smith wasn't on the finish at the time.
57.
Dimitri in the World Championships was in command, if I remember, against Florian Hempel.
57.
Had match-winning darts and ended up losing the match. And Michael, as world champion, suffered a heavy defeat against Chris Dolby.
96.
Well, Dimitri was one of a number of high-profile players who basically blobbed, didn't they, at the Ali Pali.
Blobbed.
Great word, isn't it? Great descriptive word, which
can mean all sorts.
Yeah, basically means that they lost.
434.
Happened every year in the Greatest show on earth.
Sick.
Great grouping.
I was just going to say exactly the same thing. Everyone on the top wire there. That's why they got the smile off Michael.
99.
That means he's got a bit of work to do to hold on to his throw here.
92.
The chance of Van den Berg already taking out 120.
Yeah, quite often goes downstairs with this route. But he's not going to have the opportunity, so 55. Michael Smith normally would go straight for the treble 20. And then two double 18s.
70.
We've got the one.
Meet you require 60.
First opportunity presenting itself to Dimitri Van den Berg.
Oh.
I really thought that one was going 18. In. The marker was there, wasn't it? A let off for Smith. Is he going straight for it? He is. Well, it is two apiece. I'm not sure how. Sure, Dimitri isn't either. I'm much relieved, Michael Smith.
Yes, the opportunity was there. It was close. But the fact is, it wasn't in.
93.
Spuds around the board a lot, Michael Smith, doesn't he? Normally to pretty good advantage.
91.
Such a fast and fluent player.
134.
He really did earn that win in the Premier League, didn't he, in Cardiff, beating Michael Van Gerwen, Luke Litter, and then Gerwen Price to take the opening night.
Yeah, they're never going to be easy to win a Premier League night, but that's certainly a tough route.
104.
Well, yeah, beat the defending champ, survivor match dart, beat the sports new sensation, and then beat the hometown hero.
Sick. I give by 170.
Rolls reverse, chance for Michael Smith. Now look at the ball.
140.
One thing's for sure, double 15 holds no fears for Michael Smith because he loves the double 10 and it's just next door. That's why he stayed there.
Yes, but will he get a shot? This will be magnificent for Dimitri.
Well, would you believe it? Van den Berg with a 150 from nowhere. But it looked almost certain that Michael Smith would break the throw and go ahead at the break. Not a bit of it, says the Belgian. Top quality stuff, he leads 3-2. It's a funny old game, isn't it? Looks all the way as if Michael Smith was going to win that leg. And then from nowhere, Dimitri with a spectacular 150 finish. Smith was left on double 15, and it means that all five legs have gone with throw. How important that may prove to be. Come the end reckoning. We'll wait and see, but pretty special, wasn't it?
Yeah, the three legs he's won, two 15s and a 16, so he's reduced the chances for Michael Smith. And having 12 darts in two of those legs. So he'd be pretty happy with the way things are going at the moment.
So there is Michael to throw first.
Michael Smith. Now he's just starting to get the range. There we go. Thank you.
I think that's a positive guess.
Yeah, he knows he didn't do...
96.
Well, didn't play his best, but didn't do that much wrong in that first session there. So that's the important thing.
He'll feel he's unfortunate not to be in front, but take nothing away from Vandenberg.
140.
Could have been worse for Smith as well. Vandenberg missing those darts in leg four.
Well, he's certainly come out with a purpose after the break.
Is that what you call it?
95. Michael Iriguard, 41.
He's fired up for sure. Tops. 11 darter. Brilliant from Smith. What a response after the disappointment of losing the leg before the break.
Yeah, wonderful darts from Michael Smith.
He's averaging 10 more. 10 points more than his opponent, Michael Smith.
96.
Which in effect means that Vandenberg has kept himself in it with those two big finishes. There you have it, confirming.
100.
But just the odd good shot from Vandenberg. He's keeping him in this. I should say the odd great shot.
And he's tending to do it on throw. So he's proving very hard to break.
180.
Michael Smith hit two 180s in the previous leg.
140.
I'll follow you.
Well, he took the gamble, didn't he? That he was going to fill it. But by not getting the final treble, he hasn't left a finish. And you can see in the background there that he knows he just got a bit too carried away there, Michael Smith.
425.
Great setup, but again we're in that position where Dimitri's had a good visit on throw and we'll have the opportunity to hold throw. Ooh, how close is that? Not as close as that one.
Last dart in hand, Smith did virtually everything right again. Two legs ago on the Vandenberg throw, he was left on double 15. Then he was left on tops of Vandenberg, last dart in hand.
It's that 15 dart sequence we mention a lot, because if you're throwing first, you're only allowing your opponent 12 darts at the board.
The threshold, isn't it, that they all go by. Michael Smith is averaging 101 to Vandenberg's 92, and Smith is losing.
91.
There we go, see them on the left there. The important thing from Michael's perspective, he knows he's now playing well.
But frustratingly, he also knows he's now playing a lot better than his opponent and not getting the reward for it, and that can be very frustrating. I'm sure it is.
43. Michael, 121. 37.
A bit of a mess there.
Good job he's got a cushion.
It all depends on what Dimitri can produce here to leave something. The turn will be okay. 60
Mark
maybe not enough.
14 darter, 101 average, 11 points Dimitri more than his opponent, but it's only 4 all. All 8 legs, 1 on throw. And here he comes again.
121.
Yeah, you can fire as many stats that you want.
Yep.
For the match. It's all down to the scoreline.
10 points behind on the averages and level. But that's because he's taken out a couple of big finishes and then crucially denying Michael Smith darts, which he was on a one dart finish on two occasions to break the throw.
57.
Yeah, just can't get that chance to get ahead against the throw. could see the frustration there with the troublous visit.
Sick.
Yeah, ditto Vandenberg. A good chance here for Smith with a good visit.
One.
I think he wanted more there with the first start in the treble.
I was going to say good visit, but that isn't good enough after the first start.
59.
You just feel the way it's going here. If Smith can get a break, he might just take a total control of this game. And he certainly hasn't got a break there.
Oh, he's had his chance in this leg because Dimitri hasn't scored well on throw, like he has done in the rest of the match. But the scores are level, as you can see. That bounce out doesn't help.
Oh,
that's what he wants it. Every time he's been poised to break the Vandenberg throw, Dimitri finds something. Still a chance. Not now. So Smith is finally going to get a chance here to break the Vandenberg throw.
Yep, not a bad time to do it as well. He's going to get two darts at it. And he only needed the one. Look to the heavens. Finally done it.
Game.
And he's broken the throw.
He's leading 5-4, and he's 5 out of 6 on the doubles, Alan.
Yeah, I said that earlier, he hasn't done much wrong in that first session.
Yeah,
you know, despite 3-2 behind.
Vandenberg averaging 88. It's worth mentioning because there's such a disparity between the two players as far as the numbers are concerned. But Vandenberg's timing on the doubles has kept him in this. Back-to-back.
How many times do we mention timing?
Back-to-back visits of only 60 from Michael Smith, and having broken the throw, he's doing his level best here to get the Belgian a leg.
And he's got away with it on that visit, but he needs to start hitting the treble. He's had, as you say, two trebleless visits. This is much better.
140.
Still the disappointment that it wasn't a full house.
He's just
hanging on in there, isn't he? It's like that annoying child at school who just won't go away.
Are you looking at me for? Yeah, he's certainly did it in his bit. Oh, this is fantastic, this. Triple 18 with the last one, but a great visit. Gives him a good chance to go into the break at 5 apiece and break straight back.
And it would be astonishing. It really would.
56.
He's been all over the place in this leg, Michael Smith. 15 darts thrown. Look where he is. Vandenberg can't believe his luck. Cannot believe his luck. 40 darts somehow it's 5 apiece. Michael Smith is frustrated. He's angry. His opponent is delighted. 5 all to play for the last spot in the Masters quarterfinal. Intriguing last second round game here. Saturday night in Milton Keynes, packed house. The Master title on the line on Sunday. And Michael Smith and Dimitri Vandenberg somehow locked at 5 apiece. Smith been much the better player, but Vandenberg has produced some special moments just when it mattered. Five apiece it is. Smith broke just before the break. And there came Dimitri Vandenberg to hit straight back.
Yeah, that was probably, as we said, Michael's probably worst scoring leg after he'd done all the hard work and got the break. up till then. He hadn't really done much wrong. As you said, the timing from Dimitri on the goal.
Yep. He is getting more and more and more frustrated, and the more that happens, the better it is for his opponent, who I'm sure can sense it.
58.
Dimitri has not started well in this leg, but Michael is not punishing him.
44.
They both throw nine darts and look where they are. What was it I said about timing?
Easy.
I mean, go figure. This is a weird game. Weird in the extreme.
128.
Yeah, it makes it so hard to call, doesn't it? Because, well, Michael's almost seemed in command. Is he going for it? He certainly is.
126.
Didn't need to.
Is it too little, too late?
38.
Good split. He is a known splitter. And that's why. The first nine darts thrown by each player. Woeful! Yeah. After that, a bit of razzle-dazzle, but it's Dimitri who leads 6-5.
Yes, and again, holding throw.
85.
The start of the leg was strange, wasn't it? You sometimes get that after a break, okay, but not this position in a match, in leg 11.
81.
They're both through nine, and neither one hit a treble.
120.
Not touching. Kurt Bevans, the referee, having a look there just to see if it was touching the single nine.
Party trick.
VAR.
Well, we don't want that.
No, we don't want that anywhere near the sport ever. Sing. Ever, ever.
100.
It's wretched enough at football. Looks like being 6-6.
60. 78.
Just needs to get that purple patch like he had on Thursday night. He was just so fluent, which is what Michael Smith's game's all about, really.
I also think massively that it's, he starts the year with a blank piece of paper, and not being world champion will be terrific for him in the long run as he chases another world championship title. The weight is off his shoulders. Great last dart to leave 32.
56, like you've won 32.
Can't split them.
Yes, on the top leg.
6 out of 7 on the doubles, Michael Smith.
Yeah, never been more than one leg between them.
Van der Berg averaging 88 is throwing to lead again.
Oh, 81.
Beauty of the sport, and the way that games develop, and
57.
The way that legs turn out. Of course, it's a game of numbers, but ultimately, if you're finishing, you're winning. But on this occasion, not necessarily. It's strange, isn't it? Smith 6 out of 7, and he's only level. Van der Berg's missed 8 darts at double.
415.
And getting big visits to the board, yep, just at the right time in the leg.
Well, that's why Dimitri's stayed in this. His timing has been impeccable at the important moments, none more so than the 150 finish in the
in the fifth leg.
140.
And then, you know, he's hardly throwing one treble a visit and then finds two.
Should fill it in. Or at least go for it.
With
the way he's playing, these big moments, he's going to get this.
Ooh. 81.
Well, I am surprised. Michael, I must admit.
70.
Big chance.
One dart.
50.
It's in a bad position, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was the worst possible position.
8.
And Smith again has a chance, doesn't take it. Looks like being 7-6 to Vandenberg.
There we go.
As a player, in situations like this, when you know that for possibly 80% of the time you're the better player, you'd have been in this situation. You're standing behind, you're thinking, how on earth, A, I'm not winning this, but how on earth am I losing this?
I just think the whole world's against you. Yeah. You know, you've not really done that much wrong.
46.
But again, we talk about, you know, throwing first and holding throw. You can do it in 15 darts or less, which a very high percentage of his legs on throw have been. He's reducing Michael to 12 darts or less.
140.
The more you can annoy your opponent, the better.
Absolutely, yeah. You talk about mind games.
100.
All these things come into fruition up there on the big stage.
84.
Dimitri's darts are causing Smith the angst in this match.
44.
Another negative visit. Yes, he's left to finish. Remember, he's on throw here and behind.
99. Likely we've got 164.
Totally frustrated former world champ.
129.
Well, this would do for him if Vandenberg takes this out. Oh,
go on then.
What a shot! Now, Michael Smith may as well give up. Go home. Fabulous from Vandenberg. 88 average and winning 8-6. But he's winning. Well, he's won all the big moments, every single one of them.
Yeah, absolutely terrific finishes. Not much better than that, apart from the 150 in leg five. What a time to get a break. First time there's been two legs between them in the whole match.
He is mighty frustrated. Dimitri, just keep on doing what you're doing.
140.
The fist clench with a 140 now.
Yeah, he's on throw here. If he can take this leg. One away, and you almost always feel if you're one away, you're going to get a chance at some point.
140.
Done it at the right time.
140. Committee require 48.
For a 9-6 lead.
16. I give him 107.
Now, you feel this has to go.
Well, now he has to take it. Has to. Oh, wonderful second dart.
87.
The chance was there. The groan and despair from Michael Smith.
32. The anger, the frustration. Because he's won none of the big moments in this match. And now he's trailing 9-6.
Did he make it to Michael's reverse?
It's one of the strangest games I've seen in a long while.
Yeah, certainly those first two sessions, it was just crazy, really. To try and explain that, and the statistics that we've been talking about all the way through.
140.
That's why this game is sometimes madness. And drives you mad.
For that to say, you've said that to me many times. And look at you now. But it must do. In games like this, you can see on the face of Michael Smith.
Sick.
A lot of this game is about timing.
He's seizing his moment, isn't he?
125.
Doing what he has to do. This would be an astonishing win.
90. Richie required 96.
Double eight.
88. Michael required 150.
Dimitri van der Berg is averaging 90. And he's averaged 90 pretty much throughout this game. And he's a winner. And he's through to the semi-finals of the Masters. But Michael Smith, he will scarcely believe that he has lost that game. But Dimitri van der Berg produced some special moments, some extra special moments, with finishes of 120, 150, and then crucially a 132 on the ball. And Dimitri van der Berg will play Damon Hetter in the quarterfinals, beating Michael Smith. But can't wait to think.
The Super Bowl live on ITV1 next Sunday evening. The San Francisco 49ers meeting the Kansas City Chiefs. That's a match full of superstars. Brock Purdy, Christian McCaffrey, and the 49ers take on Patrick Mahomes, Travis Kelce, and the Chiefs, who will be cheered on, of course, by their new number one fan, Taylor Swift, as if you didn't know that, in Las Vegas. And we'll have more sport tomorrow with live coverage of a new tournament. That's the Hexagon Cup, featuring some of the biggest stars in one of the quickest growing sports in the world, paddle. That's a cross between tennis and squash. And that's on ITVX from 12:15 tomorrow lunchtime. And also tomorrow afternoon, a bonus from the ITV racing team with coverage of the Dublin Racing Festival from Leopardstown. Lots of horses in action there will be heading to Cheltenham next month. So that's a really good opportunity for a little bit of research if you fancy it. That's on ITV1 from 12:50. And there's another chance to watch highlights of today's EFL matches just before midnight on ITV1. Well, here in Milton Keynes, Dimitri van den Berg has beaten the former world champion Michael Smith by 10 legs to 6 in a strange old game. Michael will be kicking himself afterwards wondering how he hasn't at least run him a lot closer. But Dancing Dimmy with three ton plus finishes, coming through with a 90 average to Michael's 95 and 42% on his doubles. Michael's 67% on his doubles. What a strange old match that was. Let's reflect on it now with the victor. It's Dimmy with Dan.
Dimitri, congratulations. Nip and tuck that game. It was tight all the way through.
Spot on. I don't have to say much words on that. That's how I felt as well.
He wasn't missing many doubles, but it's two big finishes from you that probably made the difference. 150 early on and a 132 later.
Yeah, it is about them finishes. First lick, 120, 150 to go 3-2 up, 132. It's them shots that I'm telling myself I believe in it and I can do it. And all of a sudden it's happening. And you know what? When that's happening, you've got to try and work on that energy. But you know what? I just used the word try. Try is what I'm doing yesterday and today. I try. And you know what? I'm having fun up there. I think people can see it. I'm having fun up there.
You've been doing some work with a psychologist. Is this sort of attitude part of that, trying to remain positive and enjoying yourself up on stage?
Well, there we are. You just brought it up. I'm working with a sports drink. He's giving me advice, but at the minute, the advice is all part of my preparation. It's all part of what could happen in games. We need to think. We need to pre-think that position. But when I'm up there, I've had not any bit of advice yet, so I'm like wild in my mind. But I think it's working because I am wild. I'm not really focused on, oh, this got to happen, I've got to do this, I've got to think that way. No, I'm just there and throw the darts. So far, it's my first time in the quarterfinals of the Masters. Take the positives.
Be wild.
First time in the quarterfinals of the Masters, but not the first time facing your old housemate, Damon Hetter. It's going to be an interesting game.
Why am I not surprised you've got to ask this question? But yeah, me and Damo, we've gone a long way. We lived in the same house. Damo, I really wish he was a quiet sleeper, but no. This is a joke. Yeah, tomorrow, new day, new game. Very simple. I'm in the quarterfinals. I'll take it. It's a good start. I'm not playing the best so far. I've not been like showing what I can do, but I'm still standing here. I'm still going, you know? That's the main thing.
And you've got an opportunity to turn it on tomorrow and perhaps pick up the title. Best of luck.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it, sir.
Yes, could he be a first-time winner of the Masters? Well, he's a happy chap, isn't he? We'll talk about that in just a moment. But that is tomorrow afternoon's quarterfinal lineup, and they'll be played in that order. So first up on stage, it will be Stephen Bunting against Peter Wright after Bunting came through against Luke Humphries earlier. Nathan Aspinall will meet Daryl Gurney, who is a late addition to the tournament. Michael van Gerwen against Dave Chisnell, and Dancing Dimmy Vandenberg against Damon Hetter, his old flatmate later on. Not quite sure how to analyse that interview just then. It's slightly crazy. Dimmy is slightly crazy. He's a dancing kind of guy. He's a happy guy. And he talked about having fun up there. And he was very relaxed ahead of going on stage. Back up here, he was chatting, just being his usual self.
I think if you're a player that gets slightly nervous, I think that's a good way of, you know, just getting rid of those nerves, is try and be a bit flamboyant. And ultimately, it is down to that. Just get up there and throw the darts. It's a tough game to master, but a very easy game to play, and it's easy to make it overcomplicated. And I think we're seeing a lot of players, Michael Smith being one of them. He's getting himself bogged down. He's trying to be too perfect, and sometimes you just got to get on with it and win ugly and just try and get through. All the flamboyant and high average stuff takes care of itself. Dave Chisnell being a perfect example, played beautifully in round one, had to sort of battle through in round two, and sometimes that's what you've got to do.
It sounds like it's early days for Dimmy with the sports psychologist that he referred to then. What do you think he can get out of that kind of work?
Well, in his interview, there's a sense of acceptance of where he's at. He's not impatient. He knows he's not playing his best. He's willing to trust the process. And if it can give him that little extra percent, you've got to go with it. Let's not forget, Dimitri Vandenberg would have been chomping at the bit to play here. He was knocked out the World Championships before Christmas. It's been a long wait, so he's been practicing hard. And when you're not at your best, if you can dig out results, find big finishes, it's going to help your progress. And lots of positives there for Dimitri Vandenberg. He's not going to dwell on the average. It's the result. Like he said, he's in a quarter final. He's happy with that.
That was a funny old match, wasn't it? But a brilliant, brilliant match. I do hope you caught it with us earlier, with Stephen Bunting seeing off the world number one and the world champion Luke Humphreys. An exceptional performance from him, wasn't it, from Bunting?
Yeah, he's looked very, very good. He's averaging close to 98 for the back end of 2023 and into 2024. And it's no surprise to see him playing at this level. I think because of all the success that Luke has had in the last 4 or 5 months, he was expected to win this one, but every time he put him under it, he had an answer for Luke.
Well, there's the prime example. That was as good as the match for me there. That could have turned it. Luke Humphreys waiting on the two data. But just the attitude of Stephen Bunting's, it's been great for a while now. We mentioned earlier he's made some equipment changes. 6 grams is a lot, Chris, isn't it?
And it's 50%. Yeah, he was playing with 12-gram darts, so he increased it by 50%, which is... Imagine if Ryan Searle did that, they'd be like throwing a brick.
It's a massive thing to do, but he's gone with it. He stayed patient. It didn't work out straight away, but he's committed to the change and he's played some great stuff, and he'll be looking forward to tomorrow. He's in a good half of the draw and Stephen's confident. He'll be expecting to get to the final.
Yeah, I mean, Luke Humphreys wasn't happy at the end there, just like he wasn't on Thursday night in Cardiff. So twice in the space of 3 days now, he's gone off stage fuming. It sounds as though it's to do with booing and to do with whistling. Let's have a little listen to what went on earlier.
Thank you.
What do you make of that, Chris? Is that something he's going to have to get used to, or is it all on those fans to stop whistling?
Do snooker players put up with it?
Why? Different sport, though. Different arena, different audience.
What, you think
I'm not defending it.
No,
I'm just
you
saying.
Think there's more concentration involved in playing a snooker shot or throwing a dart? You know, they're both equally tough things to do. But why darts is just something it's become tolerable? Listen, I understand it. Back in the day, you had crowds of 1,000 or 1,200. These are harder to control, but it's quite simple. It's quite a simple solution. You put spotters out there, you know, proper guys who will pick out the whistlers and take them out. There's no warnings. Make an announcement at the start. It won't be tolerated if you do it. Listen, the crowd shouldn't decide who wins and who loses a game of darts. I've stuck by that opinion from day one. There's no reason why they can't support the player. But let them play at the best of their ability, and it's just the stuff that Gezi Price has had to put up with over the years. It's just creeping in now. It's becoming something for the fans. Well, they're not fans, you know. Why would you want to put someone off? I don't get it. I want to watch world class sport, and we're not able to because of a certain group of people.
What's your take on it, Mark?
Yeah, I mean, I don't like it, but like Chris, I think it's hard to control. I think maybe not give it so much coverage. It's had a lot of coverage this week, and you need to distance himself from it. For Luke, he's just got to try and not react to it, which is hard. Sharp noises are frustrating. A constant noise you can deal with, but the whistling, and it's getting to Luke, but he's probably going to have to try and channel it out. I don't think it's something that can be sort of eradicated straight away, and the more coverage we give it, I think it'll just phase out, and I think Luke will deal with it. He'll be fine.
It's quite new to him, isn't it? All these major tournaments that he's won in recent times, and the fact that people are looking at him and fans will have their favourites and finding a way to try and get at him. Does he have to try and look like he's less bothered?
Well, that's what happens when you're a winner. You know, they build you up to turn you into a winner, and then they want to try and put you off. It's just a very bizarre mentality. And listen, a wall of noise you can play under, or you can play in silence. But when there are key moments, that those sharp noises, like Mark said, it's almost impossible that it doesn't put you off, because your brain will naturally get, you know, you will react. I just don't get it.
He's done nothing to bring it on, has he, apart from
No. Absolutely not. It's just like a trend that seems to be a thing that they do. I've said it before, that's like me going to watch Formula One and chucking oil on the track and them all spinning off, me going, oh, that was brilliant. You know, if I want to go and watch it, I want to watch things being done at its best. This is our sport, with the elite taking part, and I want to watch them perform, and I want to see them being able to perform at the best of their ability. And when you're being put off, it's virtually impossible.
Yeah, he was absolutely livid afterwards.
I don't really blame him.
But we'll see him back again soon. Plenty of big tournaments to come, of course. Well, somebody who is safely through is Nathan Aspinall, the world match play champion. He saw off Dirk van Dijvenbode by 10 legs to 5 earlier. He didn't need to be at his best. Dirk struggling with poor form and that shoulder injury as well. But Nathan looking to work himself back into form as well. And he got the job done, and he spoke to Dan afterwards.
Nathan, congratulations, you've won it. It wasn't sparkling, but you were always in control of that game.
Yeah, just another poor performance for myself, obviously, I've won. Yeah, I don't know what's going on. I'm trying so hard to sort my game out, practicing hard. Everything's fantastic at home. I'm doing the right things in the practice room, the right things off the board. But for some reason, I forgot to be the Nathan Aspinall I've owned. You know, I'm miserable on that stage and walking around, moping around. Yeah, I don't know what's going on, mate, but I'm trying so hard to get the Nathan back that everyone loves, but it's hard, you know what I mean? I've got a win there, I'm very happy with the win. It's the first win in a long time, but yeah, still pretty poor.
Is it not one of those games where, obviously, Dirk is struggling, you know that, you're aware of it. If he had been playing better, that might have sparked you into life. You feed off that kind of thing, don't you?
Yeah, but then again, I'm in a situation that I shouldn't be in. You know, I should have took control of the situation. I should have been 8-2 up, 9-1 up, and I was bombing doubles. I'm winning a leg, and it's like a relief that I've won a leg. You know what I mean? I don't know what to say. Everyone who knows me and supports me knows that I'm a fighter. I win games. I'm a fantastic dart player. But at the moment, I'm not showing it. And you know, I'm trying hard. I don't know if all the abuse I'm getting off a lot of people on social media, you know, give the guys a break, you know what I mean? It's hard. It's bloody tough on that stage. And especially when you're struggling, you know, I'm trying my hardest to get back to where I should be. You know, hopefully that might keep me on. I wanted to win the game and have a good performance, and I thought that might start my season off. I've won, not the performance I wanted, but, you know, we'll see what happens tomorrow.
Yeah, you've got an opportunity tomorrow to put things right. Go and enjoy it.
Yep, I'll try.
Well, there's a man really struggling at the moment. He is safely through, but he says himself he's really struggling, and social media abuse. I mean, it's a shame we're talking at a brilliant tournament like this about one player being whistled off again and him suffering that kind of abuse online.
Yeah, it's not ideal for Nathan. But look, if you're struggling but you can win a game, take the positive. I never worry about Nathan. He's a bit concerned with his form there. 2 years ago, he wasn't in the event. He withdrew and we thought we might lose Nathan for good. I think he's just got to work his way through. I've got every faith in him. He won the match play last year. You don't do that if you're not a class operator. I think he'll get there. And like I said, he's in the mix tomorrow and it can all change. He's a hard worker. I think he's one of the best adverts in the sport in terms of he gives it everything, whether he's averaging 80 or 100. I think he'll be fine. But obviously, there's a bit of a cause of concern for him at the minute. He's not feeling good, but he's here tomorrow. He can keep plodding.
And a word about Michael van Gerwen seeing off Chris Dobie, who wasn't himself at all the defending champion.
No, we've seen a fair bit of that from quite a few players. And sometimes you just go up there and you can feel $1 million in the practice room. You step on stage, you have your practice darts and you think this arm feels like it belongs to somebody else. But credit to MVG, put him under it from the off. And yes, at times went through the gears himself. But going back to Nathan, the one word that was used more than once, trying. Delete social media, that's an easy one.
Yeah.
And don't try so hard. You've got to be focused, but don't try so hard.
Okay, thank you very much. Don't try so hard tomorrow, Chris, okay? Nor you, Mark. We want you back fresh tomorrow at 12:45. The action split across two sessions over on ITV4 all day tomorrow. The quarters at 12:45, and that's followed by the 7 p.m. evening session with the semis and the final. So, the world champion is out, the defending champion is out, the battle to be Masters champion is wide open. Will there be a new name on the trophy, I wonder? We'll find out tomorrow. Bye for now.